Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Common Ground, A Turbulent Decade in the Lives of Three American Families by J. Anthony Lukas, narrated by Eric Michael Summerer. Author's Note: This is a work of nonfiction. All its characters are real, as are their names, the places where they live, the details of their personal lives. Nothing has been disguised or embellished. Where I have used dialogue, it is based on the recollection of at least one participant. The three families at the center of my story were not selected as statistical averages or norms. On the contrary, I was drawn to them by a special intensity, an engagement with life, which made them stand out from their social context. At first, I thought I read clear moral imperatives in the geometry of their intersecting lives, but the more time I spent with them, the harder it became to assign easy labels of guilt or virtue. The realities of urban America, when seen through the lives of actual city dwellers, proved far more complicated than I had imagined. J.A.L., New York City, January 1985. 1. Diver. Sunlight struck the gnarled limbs outside his window, casting a thicket of light and shadow on the white clapboards. From his desk high under the eaves, Colin Diver could watch students strolling the paths of Cambridge Common or playing softball on the neatly trimmed diamond. It was one of those brisk afternoons in early spring, the kind of day which in years past had lured him into the dappled light, rejoicing in his good fortune. But here he lurked in his study, walled in by books, overcome by doubt. People kept telling him this should be the best time of his life, the moment he'd been slogging toward these past 3 years. He was about to graduate near the top of his class. He'd won a highly prized position on the Harvard Law Review, and even before graduation, had a place reserved for him at a distinguished Washington law firm. Altogether, his prospects were splendid. But he'd been in the doldrums all that late winter and early spring of 1968. It wasn't the prospect of leaving Cambridge. He was as susceptible as anyone to the springtime charms of this place. The white steeple of Memorial Church breaking clean above the elms. The band, splendid in their crimson blazers, crashing through 10,000 men of Harvard on the steps of Widener Library. The eight-man crews at dusk, dipping their oars in the Charles. But such pleasures were largely reserved for undergraduates. Most law students were simply too busy. Harried from tax to trusts, from equity to evidence, they drudged their way through a different Cambridge. Many might have agreed with Oliver Wendell Holmes, Jr., who entered the law school in 1864 and recalled later, "One found oneself plunged in a thick fog of details, in a black and frozen night, in which were no flowers, no spring, no easy joys." Colin had no aversion to legal labors, no trouble heeding his professor's admonitions to think like a lawyer, for he had learned the law at his mother's knee. Etheline Diver was among the first women to practice law in a major Boston firm, though the stately old house of Choate, Hall, and Stewart had made her wait for that privilege. She'd begun there as a legal secretary in 1926, but even after she took her law degree and passed the bar, her employers had kept her passing the Hookwa tea and S.S. Pierce biscuits for a quarter century. Only in 1951, when she threatened to quit, had they reluctantly permitted her to take on cases of her own. Even then, she got only the legal scut work. Probate, real estate, income taxes, all the stuff nobody else wanted. But Etheline didn't mind. She was like a spurned lover who, deep into middle age, had been accepted by the object of her affection. It was all she'd ever wanted. When Colin was young, his mother took him along to county courthouses, where he sat in the dim old courtrooms, mesmerized by adoption or divorce proceedings. When he was a little older, she put him to work, copying ancient deeds from dusty volumes. Now and again, she took him to the firm's State Street offices, where he watched the solemn partners in conference. Colin didn't like the way they'd treated his mother. He resented it more than she did. But somehow, by the time he was a senior at Amherst, he had inherited his mother's passion for the law. He was very good at it. His first year at Harvard, he'd ranked sixth in a class of 550, thereby earning election to the law review. Later, he became Supreme Court note editor, the second-ranking position in the journal's hierarchy. Collins spent 40 hours a week at the review. His office there was crammed with copies of U.S. Law Week, manuscripts, green, pink, and blue galleys, law books, sandwich wrappings, coffee cups, and aspirin. One day, his wife, Joan, asked with a wry grin whether he wanted his breakfast served there, too. But such labors were well worth it, for the law review unrolled a crimson carpet through a lawyer's life, bringing with it prime clerkships, offers from prestigious law firms, and ultimately partnerships worth six figures a year, professorships at the best law schools, judgeships right up to the Supreme Court. The review boasted such alumni as Felix Frankfurter, Dean Acheson, Elliot Richardson, Joseph Califano, and Archibald MacLeish. It was a ticket of admission to the American establishment. The trouble was, Colin didn't know whether he wanted to join such an establishment, one which had drawn the country into a terrible war, stirring dissent across the land that spring. He was no radical. Having grown to political consciousness in the Massachusetts of John Fitzgerald Kennedy, he had modeled himself on that young paragon, idealistic and energetic, but cool and ironic. In October 1963, during Collins' junior year at Amherst, Kennedy had come to dedicate the college's new Robert Frost Library, receive an honorary degree, and deliver one of his most stirring addresses. "What good is a great private college unless it serves a great national purpose?" he had asked. "The problems we face are staggering both at home and abroad. We need the services of every educated man and woman." The president's visit was marred by what for those days was a most unusual incident. 60 students and junior faculty stood through the speech with placards calling for a civil rights law in 63. Dressed neatly in ties and jackets, they uttered not a word during the proceedings. But even this most discreet of demonstrations had been widely denounced as ridiculous and unbecoming the dignity of Amherst. Colin Diver shared that view. He couldn't imagine why anyone would want to embarrass America's bold new leader. A month later, Kennedy was dead in Dallas. Amherst's president, Calvin Plimpton, told reporters, "4 weeks ago he was here. We saw him, we heard him, and we knew him. He was one of us, for he was our most recent alumnus." Colin shared that sense of personal loss. Kennedy had been the bright star at the center of his political universe. For years, he would try to navigate by its recollected light. But by the time he reached Cambridge, student life had changed beyond recognition. Harvard undergraduates in the mid-60s were no longer drawn to Kennedy's detached and prudent style. They sought authenticity, commitment, and confrontation. Even the younger law students coming on behind Colin reflected this shifting mood. In October 1967, 50 law students from Cambridge had joined the March on the Pentagon, parading behind a large crimson banner emblazoned Harvard Law. Colin was sympathetic to the war protesters, if only because of his precarious draft status. For years, he'd stayed a step ahead of the mounting monthly calls, relying first on his college ranking and then, as deferments tightened, on marriage, law school, his first child. But he wasn't sure how long he could remain exempt. As the war news nagged at him, he had edged cautiously into Cambridge's anti-war movement. On November 9th, he had been among 400 students and faculty who filled Langdell Hall for the law school's first Vietnam teach-in. Professor Paul Bator set the tone for the evening when he warned, "We cannot let the lawyer's cult of effectiveness reduce us to immobility. Martin Luther King's bus boycotters in Montgomery didn't go through a lawyer-like screening process, and yet they started a revolution. We have to be a little bold. We have to make waves." With words like those in their ears, members of the law school class of 1968 began to make their career decisions. A few years before, choice was scarcely necessary. Through the 50s and early 60s, the overwhelming majority of graduates entered private practice, generally with large corporate firms. But the new social activism had rendered such conventional careers less automatic. By 1967, the percentage entering private practice, as opposed to clerkships, research, teaching, legal services, or government, fell below 50% for the first time. Confronted with this new skepticism about establishment careers, the major law firms tried to sweeten the pot. In February 1968, the premium New York firm of Kravath, Swain, and Moore stunned the legal world by raising its starting salary to $15,000. Others quickly followed. But cash alone had little allure for the class of 1968. According to a poll that spring, a majority of Harvard's third-year law students were more attracted by ample opportunities for pro bono activities on behalf of worthy causes. That majority rose to 75% among Collins' classmates at the Law Review, who were polled during a special meeting at the magazine's offices. Only 4 of the 24 editors said they would be greatly influenced by an offer of $15,000. Some said they would flatly refuse to work for most big firms, who always seem to be representing the giant corporations against the little guy. One of the activists admonished his more traditional colleagues, "Your natural and understandable ambition for illustrious careers seems to be clouding your vision about what is right in this country and what is simply wrong." Such was the dilemma which had bedeviled Colin all that winter. Ranking near the top of his class, he had many options, but each had its drawbacks. Clerking for some eminent judge meant more legal research, just what he'd been doing for years on the review. Government was more appealing, but none of the low-level jobs for which he qualified captured his imagination. His best route to a responsible government position would be through a private firm specializing in administrative law. But most such firms were heavily involved in lobbying for industry, an activity which Colin didn't find palatable. For months that winter, he'd agonized over his decision. He'd discussed it for hours with Joan, mulling over the alternatives, weighing one against another. He had similar sessions with his best friend and Law Review colleague, David Mann, arguing about the nature of the law. Harvard seemed to regard the law as a set of scales designed to keep society in eternal equilibrium. Colin and David could no longer accept that traditional notion, but neither could they endorse the radicals' concept of the law as a hammer to smash the barricades of vested interest. Slowly, they came to view it as a lever with which to pry up the mossy rocks of privilege, bringing air and light to the teeming precincts beneath. Or, to use another metaphor of which they were fond, most private law practice was greasing the wheels of capitalism. Neither David nor Colin wanted to be a wheel greaser. "Somebody's got to do it," David would say. "Perhaps," Colin replied. "But why does it have to be me?" In the end, neither of them found a practical alternative to private practice. In mid-February, David signed on with Dinsmore, Scholl, Coates, and Dupree, a corporate firm in his hometown of Cincinnati. A few weeks later, Colin accepted an offer from Wilmer, Cutler, and Pickering, a prominent administrative law firm with spacious offices 3 blocks from the White House. His friends congratulated him, for although it was barely 6 years old, WC&P already ranked as one of Washington's most prestigious firms. Its prominence derived largely from its most active partner, Lloyd Cutler, who was rapidly emerging as the capital's principal power broker. More than any other Washington lawyer, he had learned to straddle the public and private interest. A former New Deal official, Cutler was a 1930s liberal who called himself a believer in social change. His firm did prodigious pro bono work, from fighting a New Orleans expressway to representing black clients in Baltimore. He was the first secretary to the Lawyers' Committee for Civil Rights, later general counsel to President Johnson's Committee on Urban Housing. But Cutler also specialized in representing industrial giants in their jousts with government. His firm spoke for J.P. Morgan & Company against banking reform, for J.C. Penney on consumer legislation, for American Airlines and IBM on tax matters. He personally represented the American Automobile Manufacturers Association in its bitter struggles with Ralph Nader over automobile safety, and the Pharmaceutical Manufacturers Association in legislative sparring over drug pricing. Cutler acknowledged no contradiction between his two roles, firmly believing that differences between big business and big government were reconcilable because they were rooted in honest misunderstandings, not malice or greed. His critics were less charitable. Michael Perchuk, general counsel to the Senate Commerce Committee, called Cutler a genius, but an evil genius. Collins' decision to work for WCNP had been an uneasy compromise at best. The $14,000 salary was handsome, but to him relatively unimportant. The promise of pro bono work was appealing, but most attractive of all was the prospect of getting his feet wet in administrative law and, ultimately, in the world of public affairs. Yet his decision continued to disturb him. He felt increasingly uneasy about going to work for a man who had defended some of the seamier aspects of American business. As the winter wore on, Colin grew more and more depressed. Somehow the future had lost its lure. At the dinner table, he would lapse into prolonged silences, then mope around the apartment all evening. Joan tried occupational therapy. She bought the makings of a Raya rug, and for hours that March, she and Colin would sit silently on the couch, hooking 13 shades of yarn. Other nights, after working late at the law review, he would find himself staring moodily over a cup of muddy coffee at the huge Miro mural which dominated the north wall of the Harkness cafeteria and which somehow echoed his mood. Swimming in a bilious green sea were huge, menacing creatures, an octopus, its tentacles extended, and a sea scorpion searching for prey. Suspended among the monsters was a humanoid face, staring out through expressionless eyes, one orange, the other green. He was prey as well to migraine headaches, which incapacitated him for hours on end. Walking through Harvard Square or reading in Langdell Library, he would suffer a blurring of his eyesight, followed by a stabbing pain in his skull. Doctors ascribed these attacks to dilation of the blood vessels near the ocular nerve, but psychological pressures, particularly in highly controlled and self-disciplined people, were also a factor. Most of Colin's acquaintances regarded him as unemotional, aloof, even cold. Only his closest friends knew what strong emotions ran just beneath the surface. The effort to keep such feelings under control may well have brought on the crippling headaches from which he suffered all that spring. Now, on the afternoon of April 4th, Colin decided that he'd brooded long enough. Closing the corporate tax volume he'd been idly perusing, he stuffed some papers in his briefcase and hurried down the stairs. Walking across the lawn, he glanced as usual at the stone marker, which proclaimed, "Here assembled on the night of June 16, 1775, 1,200 Continental troops under the command of Colonel Prescott. After prayer by President Langdon, they marched to Bunker Hill." General William Prescott, who commanded the colonial troops at Bunker Hill and admonished them not to shoot until they saw the whites of their enemies' eyes, was one of his wife's ancestors. His daily walk through Harvard Yard deepened Colin's sense of connection to a significant past. Something about the way the sidewalks sliced the lush lawns into neat geometric shapes satisfied his sense of order. The sharp-edged New England purity, kiln-red bricks, black shutters, gleaming white trim, touched him deeply. Then he was out again in the dash and hustle of Massachusetts Avenue, past the bicycle exchange, down Mount Auburn Street to the apartment on Flag Street. Joan was there, feeding one-year-old Brad. Colin stretched out on the bed, picked up the Morning Globe, and flicked on the clock radio. For half an hour, a Haydn string quartet mixed with the clatter of pans. At 7:16 p.m., a somber voice interrupted the music. Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. was shot outside a Memphis motel this afternoon. His condition was not immediately known. At 8:19, the voice broke in again. "Dr. Martin Luther King, the civil rights leader and Nobel laureate, was shot and killed late today as he stood alone on the balcony of his motel." until well past midnight, Colin and Joan sat on their bed, listening to updates from Memphis and other cities, including Boston, which had begun to burn. Nothing in Colin's experience had quite prepared him for what he now felt. King hadn't been one of his special heroes. He regarded him as a courageous man who had endured terrible hardships to achieve equality for his people, but he felt little for him personally. Colin had followed the Southern Civil Rights Movement closely and sympathetically, but unlike some of his classmates, he hadn't been impelled to participate in those events. He hadn't joined Amherst Students for Racial Equality, which sent its members south to help integrate public beaches in Florida or register voters in North Carolina. Bizarre and exotic, those events had seemed remote from his own time and place. Yet King's assassination tapped some secret well of feeling. Perhaps that was because it evoked memories of John Kennedy's death. It seemed to Colin as if every great man who tried to change this country through personal leadership was going to pay with his life. Or perhaps it was because King's killing echoed the Kerner Commission report, issued only 2 months before, which had warned, "Our nation is moving toward two societies, one black, one white, separate and unequal." A paperback edition of the report by the National Advisory Commission on Civil Disorders was selling briskly at bookstores in Harvard Square. Colin and Joan had been shocked by the eruptions of the Newark and Detroit ghettos the summer before, and, like many of their friends in Cambridge, were reading the Kerner report to understand what had gone wrong. Their dog-eared copy was underlined in pencil where they had found telling conclusions. One heavily marked passage said, "In the riot cities we surveyed, we found that Negroes are severely disadvantaged, especially as compared with whites, that local government is often unresponsive to this fact, that federal programs have not yet reached a significantly large proportion of those in need, and that the result is a reservoir of unredressed grievances and frustrations in the ghetto." They had underlined the section that warned, "What white Americans have never fully understood, but what the Negro can never forget, is that white society is deeply implicated in the ghetto. White institutions created it. White institutions maintain it. White society condones it." And they had put a star in the margin by the section that went, "White racism is essentially responsible for the explosive mixture which has been accumulating in our cities since the end of World War II. The divers knew few Negroes, the notable exception being Howard Thurman, an eminent theologian and spellbinding preacher, long a friend of Joan's family. Colin had come to know and revere Thurman. When he and Joan were married, they had chosen the black minister to perform the ceremony. Thurman was a friend and confidant of Martin Luther King. After the assassination, he delivered a stirring eulogy for his lost colleague. "Tonight," he said, "there is a vast temptation to strike out in pain, horror, and anger. Riding just under the surface are all the pent-up furies, the accumulation of generations of cruelty and brutality. A way must be found to honor our feelings without dishonoring him whose sudden and meaningless end has called them forth. May we harness the energy of our bitterness and make it available to the unfinished work which Martin has left behind." Sitting cross-legged on their bedroom floor the next afternoon, Colin and Joan heard Thurman's words on WILD, Boston's soul station, to which they had tuned because they wanted to hear what blacks were saying about King's death. The station had suspended its normal rhythm and blues format and was devoting hour after hour to news and commentary on the assassination and on the violence even then rippling through Boston's streets. The night before, along Blue Hill Avenue, in the heart of the black community, angry crowds had pelted store windows and cars with rocks and bricks. 9 persons had been injured. The police were out in force. Black ministers and politicians were using WILD's airwaves to cool things while, at the same time, expressing indignation at their leader's murder. Late that afternoon, the station broadcast an impromptu discussion among black spokesmen, chaired by City Councilman Tom Atkins, Boston's only elected black official. Colin paid particular attention because he knew Atkins, who was then completing his second year at the law school. Like other black leaders, Atkins had been out in the streets most of the night, trying to quiet the crowds. Now his voice was drained and weary as he fielded telephoned questions. Much of his audience was still very angry. "You've been telling us to do this and do that," cried one young man, "and it didn't make any difference. They killed him anyway. Now what you got to say?"
"Not much," Atkins said. "Not much, my man. Except stay cool for now and hang in there. We'll get over somehow."
The next caller was a woman from Lexington, the suburban community in which Colin and Joan had both grown up. Hers was a smooth, cultivated voice with that waft of extra breath characteristic of Yankee Massachusetts. But this afternoon, it was an agonized voice as well.
"Everyone out here feels terrible about this," she said. "Please tell us, Mr. Atkins, what can we do to help you? What can we do for the Negro community?"
For a moment, there was silence. Then, his voice rumbling in the lower registers, choosing his words carefully, Atkins began. "Right now, there's nothing you can do for us. Right now, it isn't even safe for you to come in here. Right now, the best thing you can do is to leave us alone and let us try to get our act together. If I may say so, what you ought to do is to go back to your own community and try to get your people together. Try to get them to start caring, to start responding, to start looking at themselves, at their own motivations and attitudes on the matter of race. Before you can do anything for us, you have to look into your own souls." As Atkins spoke, Colin felt a terrible anguish for his country. Atkins was saying that America was already two societies, separate and unequal, and already so far apart they couldn't reach out to each other in this terrible moment. Colin contemplated these circumstances all through a weekend marked by further violence in Boston and other cities. On Monday, the law school's acting dean canceled classes for the next 2 days so that each student may have a full opportunity for uninterrupted reflection on recent events and his position in regard to them. Later, it was revealed that the dean had acted after threats from the law school's Association of African and Afro-American Students that they would picket the school unless it was closed. In any case, Colin took the dean literally. All Monday, he remained at home, reconsidering his position. At 1 p.m. Tuesday, as King's funeral cortege wound through Atlanta's streets toward Morehouse College, Colin joined 1,200 Harvard students and faculty in Memorial Church for the university's own memorial service. High in the pulpit, John L. Burkholder, a professor of divinity, declared, "Dr. King's death has challenged us to positive action. We must find new, radical approaches to justice and brotherhood." But it was Charles P. Price, preacher to the university, who pointed out a simple reality that Colin had already noticed, but nobody had dared to mention. Virtually the entire throng in the church was white, for blacks were holding their own service on the steps outside. The separate services were a mark of the estrangement between white man and black man that exists today, Price said. "We meet in sorrow and repentance for what we have done to create a situation and sustain such a gap that we cannot even mourn together." Then he led the congregation in singing "We Shall Overcome." And when they reached the words "black and white together," Colin found himself wondering, will we ever be together? As the strains of the hymn filtered through the tall windows, some of the 80 blacks gathered on the church steps jeered. Jeffrey P. Howard, president of the university's Afro-American Society, told them, "Martin Luther King would have called these people in there hypocrites. If they come out of there with tears in their eyes, we want it to be plain we don't want tears. We want black people to have a place here at Harvard. On this campus, there is as much racism as anywhere." After the service, black law students filed across the street to the Ames courtroom at the law school for a panel on the black man's view of the assassination. Colin, still brooding over the day's divisions,
tagged along, and took a seat in the back of the courtroom with a few other whites. There he listened as Bishop Hollifield, president of the Black Law Students Association, told them, "If racism and repression don't give way to justice and hope, America in a little while will be just a page in a history book. The next time the white man slaps us in the face, black people are going to kick the hell out of him. In the meantime, we here in the cloistered world of the university, we students of the law, must pay closer attention to the condition of the black masses, to the agonized voices of our brothers in the street." 2. Twyman. An hour after the transistor radios in the project blared the news of King's death, Snake and Sly were out on Eustace Street slinging rocks at the police. Around the corner on Dearborn Street, someone had thrown a brick through a grocery window, and every few minutes a kid would scamper across, grab a juicy grapefruit or a handful of plums, then dash to safety in the jiving black crowd. But soon the frolic turned serious. The Orchard Park housing project, 3 square blocks of dingy barracks and barren courtyards, squatted on the edge of Roxbury, Boston's black heartland, but several neighboring streets were still white. Shortly past 11, John McLaughlin, a 26-year-old white man, rounded the corner in his maroon convertible with 25-year-old Carolyn McElroy at his side, their radio blaring a hit tune, oblivious to the turmoil around them. As the car screeched to a halt in the intersection, a brick smashed the windshield. "Get out!" ordered a black kid in overalls. Carolyn McElroy opened her door and ran back onto Dudley Street, unmolested. But when McLaughlin tried to follow, several teenagers knocked him to the street, blood streaming from his forehead. Policemen quickly pulled him to safety, but soon the crowd had surrounded the convertible, and lifting it by the fenders, they heaved it onto its side. The fuel tank burst into a fierce blaze. At this, a long, sibilant sigh issued from the crowd, as if the fire had released hours, perhaps years, of pent-up feeling. George, whose street name was Sly, and his brother Richard, known as Snake, had been out on Prescott Street, playing stickball against the factory wall, when a little kid had come by with a transistor radio, chanting in a monotone, "Dr. King is dead. Dr. King is dead." At first, the brothers jeered, "Get out of here, you little bugger," and lashed the ball harder and higher against the concrete. But when the kids stuck the radio in their faces, they heard it too. Although they were only 12 and 14, they knew enough about Martin Luther King to feel an acute sense of loss. Their mother, Rachel Twyman, wept when she heard the news in her apartment on Prescott Street in Orchard Park. When her 8-year-old daughter, Cassandra, said, "Ma, he wasn't a member of our family, so why are you crying?" she replied, "Because, Cassandra, what he got killed for makes him my big brother, because he wanted all of us to be equal." She started to tell Cassandra that there were other reasons why she felt particularly close to King, reasons that went back 15 years to the day she had known the young theological student they called Martin. But her recollections were interrupted by a knock on the door as 2 policemen from District 9 appeared to tell her, "They're breaking into your store, Mrs. Twyman. You'd better get on down there." Rachel's specialty shop, a women's ready-to-wear clothing store, stood at the corner of Washington Street and Warren Avenue, in the heart of the area roiled that night by roving gangs of black youths. The rock thrown through one of Rachel Twyman's display windows had set off a burglar alarm, which rang at the police station. When the police tried to call her at home, the line was busy, so they sent a patrol car to alert her. But by then, all the buses in the area were halted, as were the Orange Line trains, which normally clattered along the elevated trestle over Washington Street, so the police offered to drop her at the store. Though they skirted the riot area, Rachel could see fires burning and cars with their windshields shattered on several side streets. Once a group of about 15 youths with sticks in their hands loped across an empty lot. Rachel knew her children had to be mixed up in this somehow. She only hoped they wouldn't get hurt. When the police car pulled up in front of the store, she found to her relief that the grate she'd installed inside the plate glass was still intact, and the racks of blouses and hot pants were untouched. but she noticed that the windows at Blair's Foodland down the street had been smashed and that items from a nearby variety store were strewn across the sidewalk. So she decided to spend the night on the cot in the back room. For hours, she lay awake staring at the ceiling, listening to the sirens wailing in the night. The next morning, Washington Street and Blue Hill Avenue, the black community's two principal thoroughfares, were pocked with smashed windows and burned-out stores. Police cars prowled the rubble, and only a few pedestrians scuffled along the sidewalks examining the damage. By 1 p.m., things were heating up again. Several hundred youths began marching down the major shopping streets, telling store owners to close up. On the door or window of each shop, they pasted a flyer proclaiming, "This store is closed until further notice in honor of Dr. Martin Luther King, the fallen martyr of the Black Revolution." Rachel saw the marchers coming down Washington Street, and at first she determined to defy them. The stores on either side of her had long since closed up. Carol's Cut-Rate Drugs, where her brother Arnold worked as a clerk, and Kim's Caps, which sold hats, afro wigs, and costume jewelry. But they were both run by Jews, old-style ghetto merchants who weren't very popular. Rachel's was one of only two black-owned stores in the neighborhood. She felt sure the kids wouldn't molest a soul sister. If they gave her an argument, she'd explain that she'd been on welfare until she opened the store a few months before, that she had six kids to feed and simply couldn't afford to close up. But then the marchers were on her, shouting, "Lock up the doors, sister. This is no time to be doing business." Quickly, she realized it was no use, so she placed some cardboard over the hole in her window, locked the door, and went home. Rachel didn't notice that Richard, George, and two of her younger sons, 10-year-old Freddie and 9-year-old Wayne, were tagging along behind the marchers, who then numbered nearly 1,000. When they reached the Jeremiah Burke High School, they burned a flag flying at half-staff outside, then forced their way into the school and burned another flag. From there, they marched to a Stop and Shop supermarket on Columbia Road, which was still open. The white manager took one look at the vast throng building up outside his plate glass windows, then called it a day. By 4:30, the crowd had broken up into roving gangs which began heaving rocks through store windows and car windshields. Back in the Orchard Park project, a light-skinned Negro was riding his motorcycle through one of the courts when a gang of young blacks knocked him off and beat him, stopping only when Bill Wimberly, director of the Roxbury YMCA, persuaded them the man was black. "It isn't safe to be a white man in Roxbury today," Wimberly told reporters. The mood in Roxbury that afternoon would not have pleased the apostle of nonviolence, whose memory the demonstrators sought to honor. A leaflet distributed by the Black United Front said flatly, "Nonviolence is dead. The black community faces disaster." Another, issued by two black community groups, warned, "When the riot starts, you can expect martial law, which will confine you to your home for as long as a month or more. Start your survival plans now. We must unite for the attacks upon our communities from the police, armed forces, and the white communities. Have a gun and plenty of ammunition. Nothing wrong with a bow and arrow." Others counseled caution. The Roxbury Youth Patrol passed out leaflets that afternoon saying, "Cool it. The riot squad has M16 rifles, mace, a machine so high-pitched it will make you deaf. They're not playing. Keep off the streets. Defend your home and family. Don't start anything." Youth patrol members circulated in the crowds shouting the same message through bullhorns. They urged young people to stay home that night and watch rhythm and blues star James Brown on television. "Don't go downtown, brothers," the patrol said. "Stay home. Put on the TV and watch Cool James do his thing." Snake and Sly wouldn't miss James Brown, so they stayed home, huddled around the tube, pounding their feet as James wailed, "Please, please, please." On Sunday morning, Rachel and several of her children walked through muted streets to Union Methodist Church, where the Reverend Gilbert Caldwell admonished the congregation, "Don't give way to anger. Don't destroy your own community." Rachel picked up the same theme, telling her children at home that night, Who do you think you're hurting with all this stuff? Your friends and neighbors, that's who. You can't burn yourself up.
Partly as a result of such efforts, Boston began to cool off that weekend. By early the next week, peace had been restored at relatively little cost. 21 injured, 30 arrested, barely $50,000 in damage. This was mild in comparison with what happened in many of the 197 other towns and cities where riots broke out in the aftermath of King's assassination. In Washington, for example, where 11 were killed, 1,113 were injured, and $24 million worth of property was destroyed. Or Chicago, with 9 killed, 500 injured, and $11 million in damage. On Tuesday afternoon, as King was buried in Atlanta, Black Boston paused to watch the televised services from the Ebenezer Baptist Church, the sweltering 3.5-hour march through Atlanta's streets, and finally the interment under a marble monument inscribed, free at last, thank God Almighty I'm free at last. Coretta King's haunted eyes, Daddy King's bowed gray head, Ralph Abernathy's cracked voice brought tears to Rachel's eyes. And once stirred up, those feelings wouldn't die, bringing with them memories of soft Sunday evenings years before when, after the Methodist Youth Fellowship meetings at Union Methodist, she and her girlfriends would stroll up Shawmut Avenue to the 12th Baptist Church. They weren't all that religious. What drove them up the avenue was gospel, those throbbing hymns which blended a heavy dose of spirituality with more than a pinch of sensuality. They couldn't get gospel at Union Methodist, an outpost of staid respectability, so they sought it instead at the more soulful Baptist church. Usually they had to sit through a boring anthem or two by Coretta Scott, an earnest soprano from the New England Conservatory of Music, who was often on the program because she was the fiancée of the young student minister who preached at 12th Baptist through most of 1952 and 1953. When Martin King had come to Boston University's School of Theology in September 1951, his father told him to look up his old friend and Baptist colleague, Dr. William Hester, and soon Martin was preaching most of the Sunday evening sermons at Dr. Hester's church. Even then, Martin was a commanding figure in the pulpit. The Reverend Mike Haynes, Dr. Hester's assistant, would normally have delivered those Sunday evening sermons. For a time, he was miffed at the preference given King, but soon he recognized that Martin was completely out of my league. Rachel, too, was a bit awed by the young student minister. She didn't talk to him much. He was 23 in 1952, and she was only 15. But she found his preaching spellbinding, his cool assurance impressive. She and her friends agreed he was a real bougie, a middle-class boy destined for great things. When those great things came to pass, she identified even further with King. Every time he came back to Boston, she went to hear him. Several times he appeared at Union Methodist, seeking funds for his activities, and on each occasion Rachel gave more than she could really afford, partly out of nostalgia for those evenings on Shawmut Avenue, partly out of pride in her association with this great man. She followed his career closely in the papers and on TV, and told her friends he was the greatest black man of his generation, just as Jack Kennedy was the greatest white man. After his death, she kept his memory alive in her apartment. Rachel's walls were covered with inspirational messages. There are no limits on God's ability to make things right in my life. Grant that I may not criticize my neighbor until I have walked a mile in his moccasins. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Interspersed with less reverent slogans, such as, God bless this lousy apartment. But now King became a principal theme in this display. On one wall was a bronze plaque of the dead prophet, on another a four-color portrait of him, and on her coffee table a memorial candle bearing on its circular shade an excerpt from his I Have a Dream speech. Not everyone in the family shared Rachel's admiration for King. One of the skeptics was her younger brother, Arnold Walker, who shared many of the reservations then common among Northern blacks. The Black Panthers had denounced King as a bootlicker.
Adam Clayton Powell called him Martin Luther King, and young ghetto dwellers dismissed him, with heavy irony, as the Lord. It was the migration from south to north which, more than anything else, had eroded his constituency. In the settled black communities of Georgia and Alabama, his special amalgam of evangelical rhetoric and middle-class respectability provided the right chemistry for explosive change. But in the bleak ghettos of Chicago and Detroit, these same qualities, and particularly his relentless emphasis on nonviolence and integration, proved less effective. When King delivered his I Have a Dream speech at the Lincoln Memorial, an angry black voice cried out, "Fuck that dream, Martin! Now, goddammit, now!" Arnold Walker had formed his own judgment of DeLaude up close. He owed that opportunity to Mike Haynes, the former assistant minister at 12th Baptist, who over the years had remained close to King. King had once asked Haynes to be his assistant in Montgomery, but the young minister had stayed on in Boston and eventually succeeded Dr. Hester at 12th Baptist. Whenever King came to Boston, Mike Haynes handled the logistics, meeting him at the airport, driving him around town, scheduling his time. Arnold had known Haynes for years, and when Haynes was elected to the state legislature, Arnold, 6 years his junior, became a member of his entourage. So he wasn't surprised one morning in April 1965 when Haynes wandered into Carroll's Cutrate and asked whether he would like to be a driver for King during his visit to Boston later that month. It was an extraordinary moment in the civil rights struggle, both for America in general and for Boston in particular. Only 6 weeks before, the nation had witnessed King's double confrontation in Selma, Alabama. The first on March 9th, when state troopers doused the marchers with tear gas, then waded into their ranks, swinging clubs and cattle prods. The second on March 11th, when a much larger group of marchers, including 500 from Greater Boston, finally succeeded in crossing the Pettus Bridge. Later that evening, one of the white Bostonians, a Unitarian minister named Jim Reeb, was badly beaten as he emerged from a black restaurant. 2 days later, he died of a fractured skull, and for nearly a week, the story of Reeb's death ran side by side with the Selma story on the front pages of Boston's newspapers, giving Bostonians an acute sense of their stake in those events. The movement for racial equality in Boston was gaining velocity at precisely the same moment. On April 14th, a committee of distinguished Massachusetts citizens released a long-awaited report on racial imbalance in the state's public schools. Defining imbalanced schools as those with more than 50% black enrollment, the committee found 55 such schools in the state, 45 of them in Boston. It concluded that racial imbalance is educationally harmful to all children, white and non-white, because separation from others leads to ignorance of others, and ignorance breeds fear and prejudice. Among the remedies which the committee recommended was busing, the first time such a step had been proposed by any public body in Massachusetts. The report stirred predictable protest, with Louise Day Hicks, chairwoman of Boston's school committee, calling the busing proposal undemocratic and un-American. But on April 20th, the Boston branch of the NAACP, which had engaged in a steadily escalating confrontation with the school committee, filed suit in federal district court seeking desegregation of Boston's schools. Boston blacks had been in touch with King all that winter, seeking his aid in their hour of need. King felt a large debt to the birthplace of abolitionism, which had supported his Southern campaigns with hundreds of volunteers and thousands of dollars. Besides, he had long wanted to carry his campaign into the North, where racial discrimination, he felt, was as deeply rooted as it was in the South. In that spring of 1965, Boston seemed the logical target for his first Northern venture. When King arrived at Logan Airport on the morning of April 22nd, he wasted no time in reminding Bostonians of the bonds which united him and their city. "I was educated here, and it is one of the cities which I call home," he told reporters at the airport. Then they were off, with Arnold Walker driving the borrowed Lincoln Continental on a day-long tour of the city, including a call on Governor John Volpe, an address to a joint session of the state legislature, an inspection of slum housing and overcrowded schools in Black Roxbury, a news conference, a fundraising reception at a downtown hotel, and finally, a Passover service at Temple Israel. The next morning, when King arrived at Roxbury's Carter Playground, the crowds were so thick that it took the marshals nearly an hour and a half to herd them into a procession headed toward the Boston Common. It began 8 abreast, but soon thousands of spectators joined in, swelling the lines to 25 and 30 across. Arnold marched with Mike Haynes in the second rank, just behind King and Ralph Abernathy, and when he turned in Copley Square, he saw an awesome stream of determined faces, mixed in nearly equal parts of black and white, some shouldering placards which read, "We need better schools," or "All men are created equal," or simply, "Love." And one group from the Catholic Interracial Council making a particularly dramatic demonstration of their faith in integration, with the black women carrying white babies and the white women carrying black babies. On the flanks of Boston Common, fresh with new grass, the 22,000 marchers converged on the Parkman bandstand. Gil Caldwell of Union Methodist got the Freedom Rally started with a mass sing-along. Black welfare mothers and suburban stockholders, teenage dropouts and Wellesley College girls raising their voices together in the anthem, which made each of them feel a bit stronger and more virtuous. We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe. We shall overcome someday. Then, after a spate of warm-up speeches, the man whom some that day had called the Black Moses advanced to the microphone. It had begun to rain, so Arnold unfurled a large black umbrella which he held over King's head as the preacher exhorted his flock. I come here not to condemn but to encourage. I would be dishonest to say Boston is Birmingham or that Massachusetts is Mississippi. But it would be irresponsible for me to deny the crippling poverty and the injustice that exist in some sections of this community. The vision of the new Boston must extend into the heart of Roxbury. Boston must become a testing ground for the ideals of freedom. We must not become a nation of onlookers. This fight is not for the sake of the Negro alone, but rather for the aspirations of America itself. All Americans must take a stand against evil. Standing there next to the prophet, holding the umbrella until his arm ached, Arnold looked out over the crowd, noting in particular the suburban white men in their alligator polo shirts and chino pants, their wives in lily Pulitzer shifts and silk scarves. As King's voice soared to a crescendo, the whites looked up at him with rapt faces. Sure, Arnold thought, they just love old Black Moses. Just love all us Negroes, because he's our leader and he's so nonviolent and peaceful and all. But just let us push to get something of theirs, and you'll see how they'll act. Then there'll be a different look on those well-fed faces. And these are the people King tells us we should treat like brothers and sisters. After his 36 hours with King, Arnold was more ambivalent than ever about the great man. He made mayors and governors listen when he spoke. He made people on the street straighten up and look as he whipped by in his long black limousine. Arnold was impressed by all that. And he had to admit the man was a powerful speaker. He knew how to grab these people, how to get them fired up. But Arnold didn't care for what the man was saying. He'd never been that hot for nonviolence. A few months before, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference had been recruiting people to go down south for the sit-ins. Arnold had gone for an interview, but he'd been rejected because they didn't think he was nonviolent enough. And they were right. Arnold would prefer to be the person doing the cracking rather than the one taking the cracking. He wouldn't let people beat him with a hose and prod him with sticks and hit him over the head with a Georgia toothpick while he just sat there singing "We Shall Overcome." But then King was a Christian preacher man, and Arnold had always had his doubts about them. His mother was a real Christian lady, a pillar of Union Methodist Church who went to church every chance she got, and so did his sister, Rachel. But Arnold's father had regarded preachers as father divines who robbed their own people blind. Growing up in rural Georgia, he'd seen poor sharecroppers giving preachers the choice morsels off their tables while their own kids went hungry. When he married his pious Methodist wife in Boston, he'd laid down the law. He didn't want no ministers with their feet under his table, and he wasn't sticking his feet in any minister's pew. Arnold respected his mother, as he respected many Christians who used the church to get ahead in the white man's world. But he saw how two-faced some of those Christians were. Preaching piously about do unto others as you would have them do unto you, then looking out for themselves at the expense of everybody else. The Christians had never done much for him. Gradually, he began slacking off in attendance at Union Methodist, hitting and missing, as he put it, but doing more missing than hitting. Instead, he began drifting over to Muhammad's Temple No. 11 on Intervale Street for the Sunday afternoon services. Although he could never quite bring himself to become a Muslim, he was getting a lot more out of temple in the afternoon than he got out of his mother's church in the morning. After all, he knew the minister over there as well as he knew Mike Haynes. Louis X, or Louis Farrakhan as he was later known, was actually Gene Walcott, who had grown up on Sterling Street, right around the corner from the Walkers. As early as Arnold could remember, Gene had been a star. People said he was prettier than Cassius Clay, a better singer than Harry Belafonte, a better actor than Sidney Poitier, a better talker than Martin Luther King. But then Gene went to Winston-Salem State Teachers College in North Carolina, and two things happened. First, this slick, self-confident son of West Indian parents encountered Southern Jim Crow, which was unlike anything he'd experienced in Boston. He started fighting it, using the white toilets in Woolworths and drinking from the white fountains at the bus station, challenging any white man to say him nay. But all that might not have mattered so much had he not been turned down for Belafonte's spot at a New York nightclub. When white folks rejected him for the New York gig, he quit Winston-Salem and joined the Black Muslims. Putting his talents to the service of his new faith, he composed its most popular song, "White Man's Heaven is Black Man's Hell." Soon, he became a disciple of Malcolm X, who had also grown up on Boston's streets. Malcolm Red Little had worked for a time as a restroom attendant at the Roseland State Ballroom and a busboy at the Parker House before operating a burglary ring out of Harvard Square. Sentenced to the Massachusetts State Prison in Charlestown, he paced his cell for hours denouncing God so vehemently that he became known to fellow inmates as Satan. Then he met a veteran con who converted him to Islam. Staring out his barred window at the white world of Charlestown, which rose in bleak three-deckers up Bunker Hill, Red Little became Malcolm X. By 1958, Malcolm was Islam's minister in New York, and it was Gene Walcott, now Louis X, who founded the temple on Boston's Intervale Street. When Arnold Walker heard what his old friend was up to, he came by the temple out of sheer curiosity. When he heard Gene preach, he was electrified. He took special pleasure in Gene's jibes at Christianity as the white man's religion, and at Christian preachers, symbolized by the Right Reverend Bishop T. Chicken Wing. Through Gene, Arnold was drawn to Malcolm, regularly going to hear him whenever he was in Boston. He was at the Boston Arena on August 18, 1963, when Malcolm derided King's forthcoming March on Washington, calling it the farce on Washington. He applauded as Malcolm condemned white liberals who denounce what the white man has done to us in the South while they do the same thing in the North. The northern fox is more vicious than the southern wolf because he poses as your friend. He cheered 3 months later when Malcolm told the Ford Hall Forum, "We want no part of integration with the wicked race which enslaved us." And when Malcolm was gunned down by three black assassins in Harlem's Audubon Ballroom in February 1965, Arnold remained convinced that whites had somehow contrived the death of the prophet of black pride and self-reliance. So when Martin Luther King was assassinated 3 years later, Arnold Walker and his sister Rachel Twyman saw the event from different perspectives. To Arnold, King was a great man, but also a great temporizer, a timid reformer who had long kept his finger in the dike, restraining the torrent of black rage. His death, Arnold hoped, would free blacks to make a clean break with whites and achieve a substantial degree of autonomy. To Rachel, such hopes were misguided. Boston was a primarily white city, America a primarily white nation. Whether they liked it or not, blacks had to learn to live with whites. If King's death served any useful purpose, she thought, perhaps it would persuade a guilt-ridden white America to grant a genuine measure of integration. 3. McGough. It was the moment she liked best. The vegetables spread out before her in voluptuous profusion. Squeaky stalks of celery, damp lettuce, succulent tomatoes, chilled radishes. From the sink rose the earthy smells of wet roots and peels, and from all about her the clamor and fracas of a busy kitchen, gearing up for dinner only minutes away. 3 nights a week, Alice McGough served as salad chef at the officers' club of the Charlestown Navy Yard, a break from her usual job as the club's hat check girl. Taking coats and hats was more rewarding. Tips could run nearly $200 a week, but Alice liked the sounds and smells and breezy camaraderie of the kitchen. That April night, she was cheerfully tossing her greens when she noticed a commotion across the room. A black busboy was in tears. Eventually, someone told her that Martin Luther King had been killed in a southern city. Through her mind flashed a memory 5 years old, a solemn television announcer reporting the president's assassination in another southern city. She'd mourned that night as never before, an anguish so acute it might have been for her husband or brother. She didn't feel that way about Martin Luther King. You had to admit he'd done one hell of a job for his people. If she were black, she would have been the first one in line behind him. And you had to support his crusade down south. No right-minded person wanted blacks to sit in the back of the bus, eat at separate lunch counters, or use different toilets. That sort of thing was just plain wrong. But when King turned northward, Alice had grown skeptical. When King held his big rally on the Boston Common, Alice had asked, "What the hell is he doing up here?" As far as she could see, Boston wasn't prejudiced against blacks. Nobody rode the back of the bus. Nobody was kept out of restaurants. Boston wasn't Birmingham or Selma. King was getting a bit above himself. So while his assassination was a terrible thing, she couldn't bring herself to grieve for him. When dinner at the officers' club was over and the kitchen had been scoured clean, Alice walked up Decatur Street to her apartment in the Bunker Hill housing project. Her husband, Danny, was still tending bar at the Point Tavern, but their 7 children were home, huddled around the television set, watching the riots that had broken out in dozens of American cities. For more than an hour, Alice and her kids watched young blacks racing through the nation's streets, burning, looting, battling the police. Her daughters, Lisa and Robin, seemed terrified by the violent images flickering across the screen, but her sons, Danny Jr., Billy, Kevin, Tommy, and Bobby, sat open-mouthed, absorbing the action as avidly as they did their weekly police dramas. Well past midnight, Billy took her outside and pointed toward the horizon, where the fires of Blue Hill Avenue cast a dull red glow. What did the blacks think they were doing? Alice wondered. They acted as though they were the only people who'd ever had it tough in this world. Poor was poor. Hungry was hungry. The housing project where the McGoughs lived wasn't any better than those across town in the ghetto. The widow upstairs who had to get by on Social Security and food stamps didn't have any more than those black welfare mothers the newspapers were always writing about. The discrimination which blacks had confronted over the years was no worse than the arrogance and indifference which the Irish had faced when they came to this country. The difference between the blacks and the Irish, she thought, was that the blacks had tried to advance through the civil rights movement, sit-ins, marches, demonstrations, ultimately riots, while the Irish had used politics. Alice believed in politics. It was the American way of getting ahead. And for a long while, it had paid off. No district in the country had produced a more potent roster of Pauls than the storied Old 11th, of which Charlestown was part. As early as 1894, in a race marked by bogus mattress voters, street brawls, and bully boy raids on polling places, a tough little Mick named John Francis Fitzgerald had won election to Congress from the 11th. Honey Fitz promptly repaid Charlestown's support by getting the Navy Yard reopened, bringing hundreds of jobs back to town. But his stock in trade was an appeal to Irish rage against the blue-nosed Yankee bigots. In 1905, he rode that anger into the mayor's office. Eventually, Fitzgerald's old congressional seat passed to an even more aggressive young Irishman, James Michael Curley, who also exploited Irish resentments against the Yankee nabobs. The very term codfish aristocracy, he once said, was an insult to the fish. His style was flamboyant, even demagogic, but both as congressman and later as Boston's mayor, he appealed less to narrow Irish ethnocentrism than to the poor of all races. Nowhere was he more popular than in Charlestown, and no neighborhood received more of his largesse. One of the most consistently Democratic wards in the nation, Democrats routinely defeated Republicans there by margins of 5 or 6 to 1, Charlestown did well under the New Deal, receiving one of the country's first public housing projects, the very one where the McGoughs now lived, relief assistance for 1,200 of its 30,000 residents, and a staggering 400 federal jobs. As late as 1942, at age 68, Jim Curley was returned to Congress from the 11th District. Even his subsequent indictment by a federal grand jury for mail fraud didn't dampen Charlestown's enthusiasm for the old scoundrel. Re-elected in 1944, he withdrew only after winning his fourth term as mayor. That left his congressional seat to be filled by special election in 1946. One of the candidates was Honey Fitz's grandson, John Fitzgerald Kennedy. At first, the notion seemed preposterous. Kennedy was virtually a stranger to Boston, having spent the best part of his 29 years in New York, Hyannisport, and the South Pacific. His residence in the district was the Bellevue Hotel on Beacon Hill. "You're a carpetbagger," one politician in the district told him bitterly. "You don't belong here." Moreover, his patrician gloss, the elegant ease acquired at Choate and Harvard and cultivated in London and Palm Beach, was not calculated to go down well in the waterfront saloons of Charlestown, the clammy tenements of the North End, or the bleak three-deckers of East Boston, Brighton, Somerville, and Cambridge. True, his family's roots went deep in the district. Not only had Honey Fitz represented it in Congress for 6 years, but Jack's paternal grandfather, Patrick J. Kennedy, had been born and raised in East Boston and served as its Democratic ward leader for many years. But those roots could be as much a hindrance as an asset. Boston's Irish were notoriously resentful of the two-toilet Irish who had betrayed their heritage by moving to the suburbs and sending their sons to Harvard. One who shared those feelings was Alice McGough's father, Bernie Kirk. A second-generation Irish-American, Bernie had worked for decades at a South End ink factory, where he served as a union shop steward. "The little man has to unite to get any place," he would tell his daughter Alice, and that turn of mind was reflected in his stalwart Democratic politics, his unwavering support for Al Smith, David I. Walsh, and Franklin Roosevelt. But he had no use whatsoever for Joe Kennedy, the patriarch of the Kennedy clan, whom he regarded as a womanizer, a high liver, an incurable conniver. "That man's forgotten where he came from," he'd tell Alice. "He's no longer one of us." Moreover, Kennedy was simply too close to Richard Cardinal Cushing, Boston's venerable archbishop. There was a touch of the anti-clerical in Bernie. Priests were okay when they stuck to the church's business, he thought, but their writ didn't extend to public life. Cushing and Kennedy were both overreachers, too eager to steal a march on their countrymen. There was an old Charlestown saying, up to me, but never above me." No son of Joe Kennedy's was going to clamber over Bernie's head. Moreover, Bernie was committed to Charlestown's own candidate for Congress, John F. Spring Cotter, a popular figure who had served as secretary to Curley and before that to Congressman John P. Higgins. When Higgins resigned his congressional seat, Cotter had been appointed to fill out his unexpired term. During his years in Washington, he had dispensed countless favors to his fellow townies. The Kirks had received more than a few of them, and now Bernie Kirk was determined to return the favor. Among the townies who had committed themselves to Spring Cotter was a young Air Force veteran named Dave Powers. One night in January 1946, there was a knock at the door of the three-decker that Dave shared with his widowed sister and her eight children. When he opened it, there stood a gangly fellow who stuck out his hand and said, "My name's Jack Kennedy. I'm a candidate for Congress." Sitting at the kitchen table, Powers explained that he was working for one of Kennedy's opponents. But he liked his young visitor, and when Kennedy mentioned that he was speaking the next week to Gold Star mothers at Charlestown's American Legion Hall, Powers agreed to go with him. The next Tuesday, Dave stood at the back of the hall as Kennedy gave what seemed like the world's worst speech. Halting, awkward, clumsily worded. But then the candidate looked out across the phalanx of women, all of whom had lost sons in the war, and said, "I think I know how you feel, because my mother is a Gold Star mother too." Jack's older brother, Joe, had been shot down over Germany. In the back of the room, Powers could hear some women weeping, and others turn to their neighbors and say, "He reminds me of my boy." When the speech was over, the young aristocrat was mobbed by dozens of working-class women, ardently promising him their support. Powers was convinced. A few denounced him for deserting Cotter, but working with other veteran operatives, Dave mounted a crisply efficient campaign. On a routine day in Charlestown, Kennedy started at 7 a.m., shaking hands outside the Navy Yard, then rang doorbells at every three-decker along Bunker Hill Street. In the afternoon, he dropped into grocery stores and barber shops, ending up back at the Navy Yard, where he shook the hands he'd missed that morning. In the evening, there'd be a rally at the American Legion Hall or a get-together in somebody's parlor. Meanwhile, Jack set out to acquire the more formal badges of Irish Catholic Orthodoxy, starting with membership in the Knights of Columbus. Shrewdly, his aides directed him to the Bunker Hill Council, oldest in the state, much honored among Boston's Celts. Appropriately enough, induction in the third degree took place on St. Patrick's Day. The ceremony began with 50 candidates marching through Charlestown's streets to the Knights Hall, each with a relic, an oversized key, cross, or candle, to lug along the three-mile route. Jack was assigned a special burden, a live, frisky billy goat, which the future president hauled on a leash past hundreds of amused spectators. A powerful symbol in Knight's ritual, the goat was intended to teach humility. The candidate might think he was leading it, but as would eventually become clear, the goat was leading him. After the initiation, Jack adjourned with his fellow knights to Sully's Cafe on Union Street for the traditional hoisting of the brew. It was a moment that would remain sacred to all those who stood that night at Sully's beer-stained bar. But the climax of the Charlestown campaign was the annual Bunker Hill Day parade on June 17th. The night before, townies and their guests celebrated at half a dozen banquets and balls. Jack addressed no fewer than five, then went on with Powers to an after-hours joint called the Stork Club, where he stayed until 2 a.m. Hours later, he was back in town for the traditional round of house calls before the afternoon parade. With the primary only hours away, each candidate sought to make a final splash. Seeking to exploit his image as a war hero, Kennedy marched that day under the glittering new banners of the Lieutenant Joseph P. Kennedy Post of the Veterans of Foreign Wars, named after Jack's late brother. Hatless, dressed in a dark gray flannel suit, he strode up Bunker Hill Street with more than 100 supporters marching three abreast behind him. Every few steps, someone broke from the crowd to pump his hand or ask for an autograph. The Kirks watched the parade from a friend's stoop on Monument Square. As Kennedy went by, Bernie stood stonily with arms folded. He was sticking with Cotter. But his wife, Gertrude, and his three daughters had long since succumbed to Jack's charms. Alice, then only 9, was desolate that she couldn't cast a vote for the dashing young candidate. The next day, Kennedy lost Charlestown to Cotter by only 337 votes. And elsewhere in the 11th District, he outpolled his nearest competitor by nearly 2-1. That night, at a victory party, 83-year-old Honey Fitz clambered up on a table and croaked out his famous rendition of Sweet Adeline. Almost overnight, Jack Kennedy had become an honorary townie. Charlestown voted overwhelmingly for his return to Congress in 1948 and 1950, for his election to the Senate in 1952 and 1958, and to put him in the White House in 1960. And Kennedy returned the attention. He appointed Bob Morey, his townie driver, to be U.S. Marshal for Massachusetts, and he brought Dave Powers into the White House as boon companion. Powers took pains to see that loyal Charlestown supporters received appropriate recognition. In April 1961, the president received some 300 members of the Bunker Hill Council of the Knights of Columbus, his council. For nearly an hour, the proud knights milled across the White House lawn, jawing with their president. The substance of Kennedy's policies did nothing to alienate Charlestown. In foreign policy, he was perceived as a tough guy, a battle-hardened veteran, not unlike the thousands of Charlestown men who had fought in the two world wars and Korea. There is a legend that Charlestown sent more boys into World War II than any community of its size in the country. Charlestown's vets, thrilled to Kennedy's rhetorical flourishes, applauded his firm resistance to international communism, cheered the attempted invasion of Cuba and the brinksmanship of the missile crisis. In domestic matters, Kennedy suited the townies nearly as well. For although he came to be considered a liberal, he was deeply suspicious of the conventional pieties. One strain in him, to be sure, rang with lofty purpose, summoning the nation to live up to its highest aspirations. No problem of human destiny is beyond human beings. But another side was ironic, intensely aware of man's limitations. Life is unfair, he liked to say. Something deep in Kennedy's Irish soul bespoke a tragic view of life. The Kirks and their neighbors responded to that. On civil rights, Kennedy's stance was deliberate and intensely political. Convinced that he didn't have the votes in Congress to enact significant rights legislation, and afraid that the attempt would cost him Southern support for the remainder of his legislative program, he was determined to move in this area only by executive order. Yet even here he was laggard, delaying more than 2 years in signing an order to ban discrimination in federal housing programs, something which, during the campaign, he had airily declared the president could do by a stroke of his pen. With this delay, Martin Luther King said Kennedy had undermined confidence in his intentions. Summing up the president's first year in office, King found it essentially cautious and defensive. Kennedy had the understanding and political skill, but the moral passion is missing. Even when Kennedy finally introduced a civil rights bill in February 1963, black leaders bemoaned its lack of teeth. It took the Birmingham crisis of late spring 1963, with Bull Connor's cops using nightsticks, dogs, and fire hoses on King's marchers, to create a sense of national urgency to which the president could respond. And respond he did in a nationally televised address that June, in which he said the country confronted a moral issue as old as the scriptures and as clear as the American Constitution. That night, the president announced that he would bring in a new, stronger civil rights bill, embodying the proposition that race has no place in American life and law. To support the bill, 250,000 Americans marched on Washington on August 28th. That evening, Kennedy received 10 black leaders at the White House, greeting them with the very words King had used at the Lincoln Memorial just hours before. "I have a dream." At last, it seemed, the dreams of Martin Luther King and the political exigencies of John F. Kennedy were about to converge. Less than 3 months later, the president was dead. When Lyndon Johnson capitalized on the nation's grief to push Kennedy's civil rights bill through Congress, Alice McGough and her neighbors concurred. But before long, they detected a not-so-subtle shift in the rhetoric of civil rights. No longer were politicians, professors, and editorial writers talking merely about giving Negroes an equal shot at life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. By the mid-60s, they were proposing to take real things, money, jobs, housing, and schools, away from whites and give them to blacks. This notion of preferential treatment for blacks originated with a young Irish-American, Assistant Secretary of Labor Daniel Patrick Moynihan. When Lyndon Johnson agreed to deliver the commencement address at Howard University on June 4, 1965, Moynihan drafted the text. "Freedom is not enough," the president said that day. "You do not take a person who, for years, has been hobbled by chains and liberate him, bring him up to the starting line of a race, and then say, 'You are free to compete with all the others,' and still justly believe that you have been completely fair. We seek not just freedom, but opportunity. We seek not just legal equity, not just equality as a right and a theory, but equality as a fact and equality as a result." The more Alice McGough heard about this doctrine, the less she liked it. The government picked several races and called them minorities, but the Irish, they weren't a minority. The government was saying the Irish were well off. They'd never had a hard life. Sure, slavery had been a great injustice, but she didn't see why whites who weren't even alive during slave times should be penalized for it. How could you make slaves of the majority to free the minority? Was that justice? Moreover, she knew full well which whites would pay the price for all of this. It wouldn't be those who worked in the big corporate and law offices downtown, the ones who dined in those back bay clubs and lived in the comfortable, all-white suburbs. No, as usual, it would be the working-class whites who shared the inner city with blacks, competed with them for schools and jobs and housing, and jostled with them on the street corners. Before long, the issue of compensatory rights had helped to drive a wedge between the townies and the remaining Kennedy brothers. Nobody proved a more impassioned advocate of the new doctrine than Robert Kennedy, and Bobby was among the first to point his finger at northern cities like Boston. "In the North," he told one reporter, "I think you have had de facto segregation, which in some areas is as bad or even more extreme than in the South. Everybody in those communities, including my own state of Massachusetts, concentrated on what was happening in Birmingham, Alabama, or Jackson, Mississippi, and didn't look at what needed to be done in our own home, our own town, our own city." For Alice McGough, that was sheer political posturing, designed to curry favor with Martin Luther King and the limousine liberals at the expense of working-class whites. But Bobby was an increasingly remote figure in Massachusetts. To Alice, the Kennedy survivor who really mattered was Ted. When Ted first ran for Jack's old Senate seat in 1962, there were those who regarded him as grossly unqualified for the job and resented the Kennedys' arrogance in forwarding his candidacy. But Alice and most other townies had no such reservations. Indeed, so fierce was Charlestown's loyalty to the president that it gave his brother a whopping 86.8% of its vote, the highest of any neighborhood in the city. 2 years later, with JFK's assassination fresh in most minds and Ted in the hospital after a near-fatal air crash, the townies tendered him an incredible 94.8%. But Alice's enthusiasm waned as Ted took up the cudgels for minority rights. In June 1965, just months after the Selma March and Martin Luther King's address on the Boston Common, Ted put himself squarely behind efforts in the Massachusetts legislature to withhold state funds from cities and towns with racially segregated schools. Receiving an honorary degree from Northeastern University, he told a throng at Boston Garden, "We in the Northeast say we have given opportunity to each wave of immigrants that has come to our shores. But if this is our tradition, why have we failed so far to offer similar opportunity to Negro citizens who have come from other states? It should be clear that a Negro child in Massachusetts has as much of a right to an integrated education as a Negro child in Mississippi or Alabama." Jerry Doherty, a townie ally of Ted's, warned that such positions would cost him heavily in Charlestown. And indeed they did, for Teddy had never been so much an object of Charlestown's affections as the beneficiary of its special relationship with Jack. And if Jack's advance to the White House had released the Boston Irish from their anxiety about being only half American, so it had made them secure enough to reject an Irishman as well. Ultimately, Many blue-collar Irish unloaded on Ted the pent-up envy and resentment they'd never dared to direct at Jack. By the spring of 1968, at age 31, Alice McGough was beginning to feel some of her father's sense of grievance at the Kennedy clan. She was still a committed Democrat. She couldn't imagine herself voting for a Republican, but she found herself wondering whether the Kennedys were genuine Democrats any longer, whether they really had the interests of the white working class at heart. Hours after Martin Luther King's death, Ted Kennedy delivered an impassioned eulogy to the fallen prophet. "He was a noble man, eloquent, patient, and brave," the senator told reporters. "He loved his fellow man, white and black. He died because he was willing to go throughout this country as a leader and a symbol in an effort to bring them together." Watching the senator on television, Alice felt a rush of anger at his smug, preachy tone. As usual, Ted seemed to care more about blacks than he did about his own people. The Kennedys had never had it tough in their lives. Who were they to sit down there at Hyannisport and tell her what to do for the minorities? As fires stained the night sky over Roxbury, Alice turned off the set and went to bed. 4. Diver. Scarlet. "You, Mammy, go dig those yams like I told you." Mammy. "Diggin's feel hands business. Poke in me's house niggers." Scarlet. "If you can't work, you can both get out." Pork. "Where'd we get out to, Miss Scarlet?" Scarlet. "You can get out to the Yankees for all I care." A stab of yellow light in the aisle, then a hand lightly jogging his elbow brought the mayor of Boston back from the fields of Terra. "Mr. Mayor, there's a message for you," said the usher, thrusting a slip of paper into his hand. In the flashlight's beam, Kevin White read, "Martin Luther King has been assassinated in Memphis." For a moment, he sat there wondering what he should do. Then he thought, "There's nothing I can do. The man is dead." So he slipped the note into his pocket and went back to Gone with the Wind. A few moments later, another figure loomed in the aisle beside him, the Gary Theater's manager, whispering, "Mr. Mayor, I'm sorry to disturb you, sir, but the police commissioner is on the phone. He says he needs to speak with you." The mayor told his secretary, Mary McCarthy, he'd be right back. But when he picked up the phone in the manager's office, Commissioner Edmund L. McNamara said, "Mayor, we got trouble," and went on to explain that gangs of black youths were out in Roxbury smashing store windows and overturning automobiles. With that, Kevin White abandoned Scarlet, Rhett, and Mammy in mid-saga and briskly walked the four blocks to police headquarters, where he stayed for several hours, helping coordinate efforts to control the violence before joining his staff at City Hall. In a corner of the mayor's cavernous office, his chief aide, Barney Frank, was scribbling a statement. "The assassination of Martin Luther King is a tragedy which diminishes us all. This brutal and senseless act has deprived America of one of our foremost leaders at a critical time. I hope the people will recognize anew the necessity of working together for the principle for which Dr. King lived and died, the equality of all men." From his outer office, the mayor and Frank could hear the staccato bursts of a police radio tracking splatters of violence across Roxbury and the South End. Every few seconds, a phone rang in the mayoral suite, bringing fresh alarms and cautions. Just after 9 p.m., Police Superintendent Bill Bradley called to say that a bus carrying a dozen whites was trapped by blacks on Blue Hill Avenue. The crowd had done nothing violent yet. They were standing back, chanting and jeering at the terrified faces behind the glass, but at any moment they might rush the vehicle. "What should we do?" Bradley wanted to know. "Should we send our men in?" The mayor's first instinct was to summon the police, but Barney, mindful of similar incidents during a riot the year before, warned that an armed response might only set off worse violence. At his urging, the mayor agreed to let black ministers and community workers try persuasion first. Within an hour, Dan Richardson, Chuck Turner, and the Reverend Virgil Wood had quieted the crowd and rescued the white passengers. That set the pattern for the rest of the night. Wherever possible, The mayor held the police back, letting black leaders calm their own people. Meanwhile, two black plainclothesmen cruised the community in an unmarked car, relaying intelligence to police headquarters. When they reported that the worst incidents were caused by white curiosity seekers blundering into black crowds, the police sealed off Roxbury and the South End, diverting white pedestrians and motorists. By 2 a.m., the racket from the police radio began to ebb. The mayor and Barney slumped on the office couch, trying to make sense of what was happening out there. Kevin White had been mayor of Boston for barely 95 days. With scarcely time to fill out his cabinet and learn his secretary's first names, he didn't know whether his untried machinery could handle a crisis of this dimension. The only previous test had been an Arctic cold snap in mid-January, when below-zero temperatures burst water pipes, ruptured gas mains, and left hundreds of families throughout the city shivering and hungry. White had stayed in his office all one night, and for the next 90 hours, city officials manned a round-the-clock operation at City Hall, which took 1,500 emergency calls and found temporary housing for 74 families. Partly as a result of that crisis, the mayor decreed that City Hall would henceforth remain open 24 hours a day, with two staffers on duty at all times to handle emergencies, reflecting the mayor's broader effort to open up new lines of communication with an electorate widely believed to be alienated from government. White's creative response to the winter crisis had piqued Colin Diver's interest in him. Here was an energetic young mayor who was eager to confront challenges, not run away from them. White seemed to be cut in the John Lindsay mold. Bold, imaginative, innovative, and decisive, he talked about refocusing national attention on the cities, bringing new resources to bear on pressing human needs. He had good ideas and the ability to attract first-rate people. After the cold snap, Colin watched the mayor with new curiosity, eager to see what he would do next. In fact, nothing in Kevin White's experience had remotely prepared him for the racial explosion he faced in April. True, he had won election the previous November over Louise Day Hicks in a contest heavily shadowed by racial confrontation. A member of Boston's school committee, Mrs. Hicks was regarded as the leading spokesperson for the white backlash, then believed to be sweeping Boston and other northern cities. Her bland refrain, "You know where I stand," was generally interpreted, in light of her fierce opposition to school desegregation, as a not-so-veiled declaration of bigotry. National commentators and news magazines had quickly identified the Hicks-White race as a critical test of the racial climate in America's cities, and Kevin White's victory, though narrow, was seen as a triumph for racial enlightenment. Since then, the mayor had done his best to live up to that image, naming several blacks to important posts, pledging more low-income housing for the heavily black South End, announcing plans to hire 25 black police cadets. When the Kerner Report was issued on March 1st, White promptly declared war on white racism, calling for a profound and massive change in public attitudes. But during his first 3 months in office, the mayor had been preoccupied less with black alienation than with white disaffection. For Kevin White was even then pointing toward the 1970 governor's race, and he remembered the 1966 race in which the mayor of Boston, John Collins, bidding for the U.S. Senate, lost 21 of the 22 wards in his own city. With that statistic in mind, White had drawn quite a different conclusion than most people from his victory over Mrs. Hicks the previous November. To him, the margin of only 12,429 out of 192,673 votes seemed less a triumph for racial enlightenment than an ominous sign of continued estrangement in the city's white working-class neighborhoods, where Collins had been most soundly rejected and from which Mrs. Hicks drew her greatest support. It was those white neighborhoods which held the key to his political future, and it was in them that his greatest energies had been expended. So, despite his bold pronouncements, White had given little thought to the plight of Boston's blacks, had spent little time in the black community, and knew few blacks well. He was ill-prepared to deal with a major racial confrontation, which, at 3 a.m. on April 5th, is what Boston appeared to be facing. The mayor felt utterly powerless, but he didn't think he should leave the office. At 6 a.m., he stumbled to the same couch on which he had spent the sub-zero night of January 11th, pulled a blanket over his head, and, to the wail of police sirens, fell into a troubled sleep. He woke at 9 to eerie silence. The sirens which had sounded in the night were stilled. Someone had shut off the police radio. The phones had stopped ringing. Where the hell was everybody? Then, shortly after 9, the first call of the morning came, from the black councilman, Tom Atkins.
"Kevin,"
said an agitated Atkins, who had been up most of the night patrolling Roxbury streets.
"Something terrible is about to happen."
Atkins had just received a call from a black disc jockey named James Byrd, known to his fans as the Early Bird. In addition to his duties on WILD, Boston's soul music station, Byrd was the New England representative for rhythm and blues star James Brown, who was scheduled to hold a concert that very night at the Boston Garden. But Byrd told Atkins that the Garden, concerned about more violence, was canceling the concert. It didn't take long for Atkins to realize what would happen, and now he sketched it in graphic terms for the mayor.
"It's too late to cancel it. The word won't get around in time. There will be thousands of black teenagers down at the Garden this evening, and when they find those gates are locked, they're going to be pretty pissed off. King's death and Brown's cop-out will get all mixed up together and we'll have an even bigger riot than last night's, only this time it'll be in the heart of downtown."
"They should not only reinstate the concert," Atkins said. "They should get a television station to carry it live, then appeal for kids to stay home and watch it on TV. Neither the mayor nor Barney Frank had ever heard of James Brown. Barney thought he was a football player. The mayor kept referring to him as James Washington. But they immediately agreed that Boston needed him that night. So began a frantic 7 hours of negotiation. The urbane David Ives, president of WGBH, Boston's public television station, agreed to televise the concert. But when Atkins called Byrd to tell him, the disc jockey exploded.
"You can't do that," he said. "James is in New York to tape a show. They're giving him a pile of money, but on the condition he doesn't do any other television on the East Coast until after it airs. You put this thing on TV here, and you'll violate James's contract. He isn't going to like that."
When Atkins persisted, Byrd suggested he call Greg Moses, Brown's manager. Moses was dubious.
"Look, even if we can work out the contract thing, we got another problem. It's going to kill our gate. We're going to take a bath on this thing. Who's going to take care of James?"
Atkins called White and said, "We got to tell these people we'll guarantee the gate." At first, the mayor flatly refused. Ultimately, under Atkins' pleading, he agreed.
"But for Christ's sake," he said, "don't tell anybody. If word ever gets out we underwrote a goddamn rock star with city money, we'll both be dead politically."
Atkins called Moses back and assured him the city would guarantee the difference between what Brown would have made from a full house and what he actually took in that night. Moses gave a tentative, very uneasy assent, for he had been unable to clear it with Brown, already on his way to Boston in his private Learjet. Atkins promised to meet the singer at the airport and explain the whole thing. In the mayor's limousine, led by a wedge of police motorcycles, Atkins rushed to the airport, picked up Brown, then sped back through the Callahan Tunnel while hurriedly outlining the situation to the outraged star.
"No way," Brown shouted. "They'll sue me in New York."
"James, James," pleaded Atkins. "We'll work this out, but right now you have an opportunity to help save this city."
"I'll have to think about it," Brown grumbled.
When they screeched up to the Garden, Brown was met by Eddie Powers, the Garden's manager, who reported that people had been coming in all day getting refunds.
"This concert has been killed," Brown roared.
At that moment, the mayor pulled up, and he, Brown, and Atkins huddled in the manager's office. By then, Brown had figured out what the whole thing was going to cost him and demanded a city guarantee of $60,000.
$60,000?
The mayor exclaimed. Martin Luther King had just been killed, and here were two black guys putting the squeeze on him for $60,000. One of them, he'd been told, was the highest-paid black performer in America, who made $2 million a year, had a Victorian mansion, a Rolls Royce, two Cadillacs, two radio stations, a record company, a production staff of 42. Now he was worrying about the gate from one measly concert.
But White was running out of options. "Okay, Mr. Brown," he said. "You've got your commitment. Now get up on that stage."
Barely 2,000 young people, most of them black, were scattered around the 14,000-seat arena when Tom Atkins advanced to center stage.
"I'm not going to sing, but I do want to say this," he began. "James Brown has donated his money and his time to help people. He donated one of his biggest selling records to the young people of our country. And tonight, he's making a $2,500 contribution to the Martin Luther King Trust Fund. For those of you who are not with us here tonight, but are watching, I think it would be sort of great if you were to make out a check to the Martin Luther King Trust Fund and send it to City Hall, care of Mayor Kevin White. Anyway, this country owes James Brown a great debt, and we're lucky to have him here tonight with us. Give a great round of applause to James Brown."
The audience thundered its approval. Then Atkins went on.
"I'd like to bring now to the microphone the man who is making the program tonight possible. The man whose foresight and leadership has given the city of Boston and the whole metropolitan area a new lease on life. He's a man who's young, he's a man who cares, and he's going to make this a great city. The Honorable Mayor..."
Dapper, in a dark blue suit, button-down shirt, and rep tie, Kevin White ducked into the spotlight. The crowd's response was, at best, subdued. It was the first time since King's assassination that the mayor had confronted a large group of blacks. Sensing the ghetto's new rage at whites, Atkins and other black advisors had urged him to stay off the streets. Gazing now into the vast arena, squinting against the Klieg lights, White feared that someone up there in the balconies might try to avenge the prophet's death. Sensing the mayor's anxiety and the crowd's hostility, Brown took the microphone.
"Just let me say," he assured his constituency. "I had the pleasure of meeting him, and I said, 'Honorable Mayor,' and he said, 'Look, man, just call me Kevin. And look, this is a swinging cat.' Okay, yeah, give him a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. He's a swinging cat."
With the crowd more receptive now, the mayor said, "All of us are here tonight to listen to a great talent, James Brown. But we're also here to pay tribute to one of the greatest Americans, Dr. Martin Luther King. 24 hours ago, Dr. King died for all of us, black and white, that we may live together in harmony. Now I'm here tonight to ask you to make Dr. King's dream a reality in Boston. This is our city, and its future is in our hands. So all I ask you tonight is this. Let us look at each other, here in the garden and back at home, and pledge that no matter what any other community might do, we in Boston will honor Dr. King in peace. Thank you." As White finished, Brown cried,
"The man is together!"
Then he launched into the distinctive routine which had earned him the sobriquet Mr. Dynamite. Flanked by two moaning saxophones, lit by pulsing strobes, he batted the microphone between his palms, bringing it close, pushing it away, gyrating, twisting, and sliding. His skin slick with sweat, he stripped the jacket from his three-piece suit, tossed it into the wings, then began a frenetic rendition of "Has Everybody Got the Feeling?" At that, his young fans in the front rows could no longer contain their enthusiasm. Jumping on the stage, they grabbed at their idol's hands and hair. Police pushed them back, while Brown pleaded,
"Let me finish the show! We're all black! Let's respect ourselves! Are we together, or are we ain't?"
"We are,"
the crowd chorused back, and they were. Scattered violence erupted in Roxbury that night, but the downtown riot never materialized. As expected, thousands of young blacks stayed home to watch the concert. But 3 days later, the city's delicate deal with Brown came close to collapse. On Monday morning, Greg Moses called Atkins to say the city was backing off. Atkins quickly dialed the corporation counsel, Herb Gleason.
"We never really gave the guarantee," Gleason said. "We were only discussing it."
"Herbie," Atkins said,
"it was a firm agreement."
"Well, I don't know where we're going to get the money."
"Write a damn check on the city treasury."
"We can't do that."
"Well, I'm not going to let you back off," Atkins said, warning that if he hadn't heard from Gleason by noon,
He was going to introduce a resolution in the city council, laying out the whole story and calling on the mayor to fulfill his commitment. At 11:50, Gleason called to say, "Brown will get his money." But the mayor didn't have the money. Everyone agreed it couldn't come out of the city treasury. Tom Atkins' televised appeal for a Martin Luther King trust fund had elicited barely $5,000, most of it from liberal white suburbanites. A few large private donors were tapped with little success. So the mayor turned to the one source which could come up with such money on short notice, the vault. In the late 1950s, shabby and decrepit Boston had drifted toward a financial crisis, a forerunner of the credit squeeze which would plague many municipalities two decades later. When Boston tried to raise desperately needed capital with a bond issue, Moody's Investor Services rated its bonds lower than those of any other large American city. The Athens of America, once the financial capital of the colonies, the home of generations of parsimonious Yankees, was now ranked below Cincinnati or Denver. To the Brahmin bankers, this was simply unacceptable. Convinced that Boston was headed for municipal bankruptcy, the sachems of State Street resolved to control that process. If the city had to go into receivership, then the banks and major corporations were determined to have a mechanism in place to administer the wreckage. This effort was spearheaded by Charles A. Coolidge, senior partner in Ropes and Gray, Lloyd Brace, president of the First National Bank of Boston, Carl Gilbert, president of the Gillette Company, and Ralph Lowell, board chairman of the Boston Safe Deposit and Trust Company. Widely known as Mr. Boston for his astonishing range of civic enterprises, Lowell became chairman of the new group, which met in his company's boardroom. Lloyd Brace brought his bank's senior vice president, Ephron Catlin, along as treasurer. The consortium convened in utmost secrecy, but a few scraps of information inexplicably reached the press. One newspaper dubbed the new group The Vault, and the name stuck. By 1959, State Senate President Johnny Powers seemed all but certain to become Boston's new mayor. Distrusting Powers, whom they saw as the prototype of the big-spending Irish Paul, the bankers considered several ways of forcing the city into bankruptcy and giving them control of municipal finances. Nevertheless, regarding Powers' election as a foregone conclusion, they reluctantly supported him. Only at the last moment did several vault principals quietly open channels to Powers' opponent, Register of Probate John Collins. When Collins scored an astonishing upset, he shrewdly forged an alliance with Charlie Coolidge and his colleagues. Every other Thursday at 4 p.m., Collins met with the vault in the boardroom of the Boston Safe Deposit and Trust Company. Against all precedent, the Irish mayor and the Yankee bankers collaborated intimately on the New Boston, then rising on the twin cornerstones of fiscal responsibility and a revived downtown. Time and again, the vault produced substantial sums for the mayor's cherished projects, while raising money for him to hire experts at salaries well above budgeted levels. When Collins decided not to run for re-election in 1967, he mobilized his financial backers behind a hand-picked successor, redevelopment director Ed Logue. If Kevin White instinctively distrusted the Yankee establishment, he particularly resented its determined support for his opponent. Once in office, he pointedly kept his distance from the business community, only reluctantly attending a couple of vault meetings. Yet now, as he sought the money for James Brown, his thoughts naturally turned to the vault. Why shouldn't he tap their ample resources? Indeed, with all the money represented around that table, why stop at $60,000? The long, hot summer was nearly upon them. Even in the best of years, funds would be needed to put young blacks to work and expand inner-city recreation. One day in mid-April, White made his pitch to the vault. Around the mahogany table that afternoon was the core of the original membership: Lowell, Coolidge, Brace, Gilbert, Catlin. And there were some new members, too, for the vault had gradually expanded to embrace most of Boston's principal business and financial leaders, among them Frank Farwell of the Liberty Mutual Insurance Company, Eli Goldston of Eastern Gas and Fuel Associates, Richard Chapman of the New England Merchants Bank, Richard Gumry of Filene's department store, and Edward Mitten of Jordan Marsh. Had a Marxist revolutionary sought to wipe out the city's ruling class in one stroke, he could scarcely have done better than plant a bomb in the boardroom of the Boston Safe Deposit and Trust Company that day. Seated at the head of the long, polished table, the mayor delivered his appeal. He explained the James Brown problem, then went on to talk of the tinderbox in Roxbury, the need for emergency palliatives to cool things off until longer-range projects could be brought to bear. "How much, Mr. Mayor?" asked the blunt Eli Goldston. "Well," White ventured nervously, "it's hard to put a dollar figure on it, but I should think, well, it cost me $1 million to run for mayor, so maybe in the neighborhood of $1 million. After a short pause, Ralph Lowell spoke up. "Mr. Mayor, in all the years we dealt with your predecessor, we never came up with anything remotely like that. I'm afraid the figure you mention is out of our league." Oh, come off it, the mayor thought, looking around the room at all those pinstripes. But what he said was, "Well, gentlemen, the city is at stake here, so whatever you think you can do." Then he got up and walked back to City Hall. When he entered his office, barely half an hour later, his secretary said, "You have a call from Charles Coolidge." The mayor picked up the telephone and Coolidge snapped, "Mayor, you have $100,000 on account. Have one of your people talk to F. Catlin." Catlin later explained what had happened in the boardroom during the mayor's walk. "Well, we had some pretty fierce arguments about that James Brown thing. Some of our fellows just didn't go for that at all. But the mayor had persuaded us that if we didn't come up with the money, the blacks were going to burn the city down, so we thought we better do something." Over the next year, the money in what came to be known as the mayor's special fund was doled out to a long list of projects, controlled by Barney Frank. Off the top, of course, came $15,000 for James Brown, reduced from the original $60,000, largely because the city put pressure on the garden to waive its share of the receipts. Some of the money went to the city's new human relations task force, set up after the assassination to help cool things in the black community. The task force and its successor, the Office of Human Rights, were principally financed from the regular city budget, but the special fund secretly paid a small cadre of black informants and operatives who, had they been on the official payroll, might have been accused of selling out to the establishment. Most of the money went to more prosaic projects in the black community. The Roxbury Beautification Program and a similar cleanup drive, both designed to keep black youngsters busy during the summer. Equipment for a teenage football team, a contribution to the Roxbury YMCA, tickets for 200 black kids to see the ice capades at the garden. The Orchard Park housing project, where Rachel Twyman and her 6 children lived, received a disproportionate share of the money, perhaps because it had been the site of some of the worst violence following King's assassination. Some $1,500 went to finance a summer festival there called the Orchard Park Thing, a week-long bash of rock concerts, games, and food, hugely enjoyed by the Twyman kids. Another $600 helped equip an Orchard Park security patrol, made up of men in the project fed up with crime and vandalism. And $100 went to the nearby Robert Gould Shaw House, the settlement house which Mrs. Twyman, her brothers and sisters, and now her children, attended. Such expenditures were merely stopgaps, fire breaks to hold back the Holocaust. More grandiose plans were being contemplated. The Sunday after King's assassination, Sheldon Apple, a Boston paper box manufacturer, was at breakfast in suburban Newton when he noticed an article on page 1 of the Herald headlined, "Cities Negroes Cool Their Own." It told how Bill Wimberly, director of the Roxbury YMCA, and his sidekick, Marvin Butler, had rescued a white man badly beaten in Roxbury that week, and how they had otherwise sought to control violence in the black community following King's death. The Herald had selected Wimberly and Butler to represent the hundreds of black community leaders, ministers, and social workers who had been out in the street trying to cool things during the riots. The reporter closed his piece. "Bill Wimberly sat in his office with the green curtains drawn back and and the April sun shining in on him, thinking about the summer. We need a gym here real badly. It will cost $250,000. We can't raise it in the black community. We need help.
Shelley Apple had been overwhelmed by King's assassination and was feeling, as he later put it, the guilt of centuries. Putting down the paper, he exclaimed to his wife, "Somebody ought to help these guys. Here their leader has been gunned down and they spend all their energies trying to save white people. My God, I've got to do something. This is something I can do."
During the next few days, Apple called friends and acquaintances asking them to help raise money for the gym. Someone suggested he try Ralph Hoagland, president of Consumer Value Stores, a Massachusetts chain of cut-rate drugstores. Hoagland was something of a phenomenon in Boston business circles, a Princeton and Harvard Business School graduate who, while still in his 20s, had built CVS into a multi-million dollar enterprise. But he approached his social responsibilities with equal intensity. In 1961, while still at the business school, he asked one of his professors how he could help Negroes. "Why don't you teach them what you learned last year?" the professor suggested. So that fall, Hoagland began teaching business at a Roxbury social service agency to a mixed group of clothes pressers, junk men, and house painters. He was convinced that if he could pass along what he knew to these black men, they could make it in the business world. But it rarely worked, usually because his students lacked the necessary capital. Once he founded CVS, he dropped the course, but he retained a burning conviction that such men could make it if only they could put expertise and capital together. Staggered by King's death, he was more than receptive when he got a call from Shelley Apple. 9 people gathered in the Hoagland's living room on Saturday, April 13th. Quickly, they abandoned the gym idea. As Ralph Hoagland put it, "Blacks don't need more basketball courts. They do very well as it is bouncing the ball off a stoop. We have to shoot for something bigger than that." But they couldn't agree on what that should be. One by one, the guests began drifting away, leaving Apple and Hoagland staring at each other over the coffee cups. "Well," Shelley Apple said, "I guess it's up to us." They agreed to meet again at Apple's home on April 22nd. In the meantime, Hoagland spoke with his black friends, among them Bryant Rollins, a young writer and social activist, who told him, "You want to help us? Then give us the money and let us decide what we're going to do with it. The time is over for white people to be telling blacks what to do. We're going to control our own destiny now." In part, Rollins reflected the stance of the Black United Front, a new umbrella organization embracing nearly all of Boston's major black groups, from the Urban League to the Black Panthers, formed that January following a visit by Stokely Carmichael. After King's assassination, the front demanded a large dose of self-determination, or, in the lingo of the times, community control, for Boston's black neighborhoods. On April 8th, 5,000 blacks gathered in a Roxbury sports stadium. With whites excluded, they approved 21 demands. Among them, "As of Monday, April 8th, all white-owned and white-controlled businesses will be closed until further notice, while the transfer of the ownership of these businesses to the black community is being negotiated through the United Front. Every school in the black community shall have all black staff, principals, teachers, and custodians. All schools within the black community are to be renamed after black heroes. Names will be selected through the United Front. The black community must have control of all public, private, and municipal agencies that affect the lives of the people in this community. The mayor's office is to mobilize the Urban Coalition, the National Business Alliance, and the white community at large to immediately make $100 million available to the black community." The United Front's demands drew an angry response from Kevin White, who could hardly be expected to welcome steps which would weaken his political control over the city. "I understand and feel the anguish which spawned it," he said. "I will not by one word or one act add to the delusion that it is rational, workable, or dignified either for black or white. Racism is obscene by whomever proposed, black or white, and social reform rarely benefits from expropriation." The mayor coupled his flat rejection of the front's demands with praise for simultaneous proposals by the Boston branch of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, which had broken with the front. White called the NAACP's proposals, which included stricter housing code enforcement and the hiring of more black policemen, a worthy basis for serious implementation. Ralph Hoagland did not share the mayor's reservations. Indeed, he was excited by the boldness of the United Front's vision. Ultimately, the Front saw the black community separating politically from Boston and forming a new city. When he, Apple, and half a dozen others met on April 22nd, Hoagland persuaded the group to accept an extraordinary proposition: that they set out to raise the $100 million included in the demands and give it to the Front, no strings attached. To screen out those not truly dedicated, they would ask for a minimum of $1,000 per person and one day a week to be devoted to a skills bank, which would help blacks develop expertise in business and finance. Moreover, they agreed that the real problem was not in Roxbury, but in Newton and other suburbs like it where white racism prevailed. While striving to help the black community, they must also educate the white community on their moral responsibility to erase racial inequality. They resolved to begin with a series of recruiting breakfasts held in their homes at 7 o'clock on weekday mornings. The hour was Apple's idea. "People are always telling you they're tied up for lunch or dinner," he explained, "but nobody can tell you they're busy at 7 a.m. The only reason for refusing a 7 a.m. invitation is that they're too lazy or not committed enough. We don't want those people anyway." The founding members of what came to be known as Fund for United Negro Development, could scarcely be accused of either laziness or lack of commitment. Ralph Hoagland, in particular, largely abandoned his drugstore chain for months on end as he worked 16 hours a day raising money for Fund and serving as the principal go-between with the black community. Hoagland, Apple, and the others brought the same almost religious zeal to their recruiting for Fund. One Fund officer told another, "Now I think I know what it must have been like in the early days of Christianity." And at first, it paid off. Over the next months, they held hundreds of 7 o'clock breakfasts throughout Boston's ring of white suburbs and brought in an impressive roster of members at $1,000 apiece. At the start, the recruits came principally from among their friends in the liberal Jewish communities of Newton and Brookline. But gradually during the weeks following King's assassination, it became fashionable to ante up for the black community. Senator Edward Kennedy was an early donor. So were Mrs. Henry Cabot Lodge, wife of the ambassador to the Federal Republic of Germany, and the ambassador's son, George. Fund's membership list was a tightly held secret, but most of those who joined the organization were substantial citizens of the Yankee suburbs. Among them, Robert Saltonstall of Ralph Lowell's Trust Company, Philip Weld, publisher of the Beverly Times, Standish Bradford of the law firm of Hale and Dorr, and Francis Hatch, a state representative from the North Shore. One wealthy suburbanite even gave Fund his Porsche. There were failures, too. Hoagland took a long walk up the Ipswich beach with novelist John Updike, but came away empty-handed. And Joan Diver went to a Fund meeting at the home of friends on Beacon Hill, but gave nothing, partly because the Divers didn't have that kind of money, partly because they harbored doubts about Fund's approach. The early money-raising went so well that on May 23rd, Fund presented the United Front with its first installment, a check for $75,000. But that was a long way from $100 million. Soon, Fund's leaders realized that if they were going to reach that goal, they needed to get it in larger chunks. One day, Hoagland and Harvard theologian Harvey Cox lunched with Robert Slater, president of the John Hancock Insurance Company and chairman of Boston's branch of the Urban Coalition, a year-old organization which sought to enlist big business in the war on urban poverty. In a private dining room at the Somerset Club, they asked Slater to funnel some of his vast resources into Fund. "No, I won't," he said, "and I'll tell you why. The people you're dealing with are mafia and communists." Indeed, much of Boston's establishment, black as well as white, regarded the United Front's leaders as either crooks who would take the money and run to Brazil, or revolutionaries who would buy guns and bombs. Among those who harbored such suspicions was Kevin White. When Fund's leaders went to see him at City Hall, he castigated them for picking the wrong black cats and warned, "If they go out and buy machine guns, I'm holding you people personally responsible for the bloodbath that ensues." 6 months later, one of the Front's leaders, an ex-con named Guido Saint Laurent, who headed the New England grassroots organization, Negro, was in fact gunned down with two of his aides in what police called a gangland-style murder. But most United Front members were well-intentioned, if clumsy, social activists. The $1 million which Fund presented to the Front between 1968 and 1972 went principally into loans for small black enterprises, most of which eventually went out of business. Quixotic and ill-conceived as it was, the Fund United Front Alliance outraged City Hall and State Street principally because it skirted the traditional channels of private philanthropy and good works, because it involved, both as donors and as recipients, volatile new forces in the community who wouldn't play by the old rules, and because it threatened established institutional relationships. If substantial money could flow from progressive Jewish businessmen and their guilt-ridden Yankee allies to a bunch of militant, aggressive blacks determined to control their own community, it could at least temporarily discomfit the old money represented in the vault, established interests among the black middle class, and, of course, the mayor, whose political ambitions depended on mobilization of existing power bases. Not surprisingly, in the weeks following Fund's affiliation with the Front, these traditional interests began to coalesce. Robert Slater besieged the mayor's office, seeking socially responsible channels through which the Urban Coalition and the Hancock could deal with Boston's urban crisis. So impatient did Slater become that one mayoral aide dubbed him the quivering mass of money. The mayor was characteristically skeptical about this abrupt shift in the business community's stance. "All of a sudden," he said, "everybody wants to enlist in the battle to save the black man and the city." White was particularly bemused by Bob Slater, a flamboyant wheeler dealer who took big chances with the Hancock's money and talked of running for governor. Early in 1968, Slater announced plans for a spectacular new company headquarters, 60 stories of reflecting glass towering over the back bay. There were some who believed that his passionate attention to minority needs was somehow related to the new building's precarious site on the rim of the black community. Its 5,000 windows would make tempting targets in any disturbance. Skeptics suggested that the company was taking out riot insurance. For the time being, though, Robert Slater's interests coincided with Kevin White's. On May 13, 1968, in a full-dress City Hall news conference, White proclaimed that Boston's banks and insurance companies would provide $50 million for low-income housing through new construction, rehabilitation, and liberalized mortgages on existing homes. In addition, he announced formation of a Boston Urban Foundation to invest $6 million in minority business ventures and a skills bank to assist such businesses. Much of the program, notably the foundation and the skills bank, bore striking similarity to the Fund Front program. The Front's response was predictable, labeling the mayor's scheme a sham, an insult to the black community, a hypocritical and superficial political move. Indeed, little came of it, except for some increased mortgage financing and a few ambitious, though ultimately abortive, projects sponsored by the Hancock. Years later, Kevin White conceded that the whole thing was a floral piece. The ubiquitous Efren Catlin, who cropped up again as one of its promoters, privately called it a wind puppy, an old Yankee term for a dog who looks pregnant but is actually bloated by gas. Not all of Kevin White's activities in this period were so flatulent. An intensely political man, White responded to political imperatives, and after King's assassination, the black community claimed his attention. Wasting no time, he loosed a volley of statements and gestures that soon led working-class whites to label him Mayor Black. On April 9th, the day King was buried in Atlanta, White issued a statement describing himself as Dr. King's disciple.
By then, the mood in Roxbury had cooled sufficiently for the mayor to walk the streets. Accompanied by Jeep Jones, he strolled up Blue Hill Avenue that afternoon, played basketball with a group of teenagers, dropped in on several civil rights organizations, and shook every hand in sight. 3 days later, White swallowed his pride and met with 15 representatives of the United Front, saying, "I have no desire to stifle the dialogue that is so necessary to make progress in this critical area." And on April 20th, he spent all day at a conference on black employment, sponsored jointly by his office and Roxbury churches. Closing the conference that Saturday afternoon, he concluded that the overriding need in the ghetto is not employment per se, but rather the development of black entrepreneurship. 3 hours later, Kevin White kept a long-standing commitment to address the 81st annual banquet of the Harvard Law Review, which was held in the central hall of the Harvard Club, a vast four-story chamber with a floor of Tennessee marble, walls of Flemish oak, and six arched windows rising to a beamed ceiling hung with Italian chandeliers. Assembled in this baronial splendor were the current editors and their predecessors from years gone by, members of Congress, federal and state judges, professors from the leading law schools, distinguished practitioners from Wall Street, State Street, and Broad Street, all turned out in white starched shirts, black ties, and dinner jackets. After an ample dinner, the speeches began. Irwin Griswold, former dean of the law school and now the U.S. Solicitor General, spoke of differing perspectives in Cambridge and Washington. Nicholas Katzenbach, the former Attorney General and now Under Secretary of State, spoke of respect for the law. Kevin White spoke of the agony of the American city. "The Holocaust that has ripped through our cities over the last 2 years, indeed during the past 3 weeks," he said, "gives us ample testimony to the magnitude of the problem. I bring tonight the conviction that if we are somehow to escape destruction, we must accept without reservation the proposition that the plight of the black man is the greatest single crisis in America today, the axis around which every other problem revolves." The Kerner Report, he said, had outlined the alternatives open to American cities. They could stick with present policies, relying on economic growth to improve the condition of blacks. They could choose enrichment, increasing spending for social programs, but leaving the Negro isolated in the ghetto. Or they could opt for integration, reversing the nation's drift toward two societies, black and white, separate and unequal. White declared for integration. "The time has come for me after 100 days in office, and for this nation after 100 years, to put, as Lincoln did, the preservation of the Union above all else, the creation of a single society of white and black above all else. This is our commitment in Boston. I need your assistance. I hope there are those here among you, among the very best young lawyers America has produced, who will choose to join us in this commitment." As the mayor's words died away, there was a split second of silence, then the rustle of hundreds of napkins against dinner jackets as the phalanx of lawyers rose to give him an ovation. At his table in the rear, Colin Diver stood transfixed, staring at the youthful Kevin White behind the rostrum. On the ride back to Cambridge, he and David Mann shared their enthusiasm for the mayor's speech. Somehow White had captured just the sense of urgency, of moral commitment, of sacrifice that had been gestating in them all through that long winter. Back at the Diver's apartment on Flag Street, Joan Diver and Betsy Mann were waiting. Over coffee, their husbands told them about the mayor's speech. For more than an hour, the two couples talked of cities, blacks, integration, and community control. It was well past 1 a.m. when Colin turned abruptly to David Mann and said, "I dare you to come down with me next week and take the mayor up on his offer." "What offer?" Mann countered. "That wasn't an offer." "Sure it was," Colin replied. "He said he hoped some of the bright young lawyers in the room would help him out. There were only 24 guys in the room who are graduating this year. We're two of them. He must have meant us." "Oh, who knows if he even has any jobs? Let's find out." Joan and Betsy reinforced Colin's enthusiasm. Neither woman wanted her husband to sign on with a corporate law firm. The more Joan thought of Colin's idea, the more she liked it.
"It's the right thing to do," she said. "We've been saying all along we don't care that much about money. What's important is doing something for people, helping the city survive."
On Monday, Colin called Barney Frank to set up an appointment. Barney seemed taken aback, but said, "Sure, come on down." On Thursday, he met with the two law students for an hour, but could promise nothing concrete. He was simply unprepared for volunteers. When the mayor heard that two law review editors had actually responded to his speech, he was flabbergasted. It had never occurred to him that anybody would take him literally. Put off by Barney's vagueness, Dave Mann backed out, deciding to stick with his Cincinnati job. But Colin wasn't easily discouraged. He called Sam Merrick, one of the mayoral aides who Frank said might need an assistant. Merrick did and offered him the job. It paid only $8,000, a $6,000 cut from what he could have earned in Washington. But by then, Colin's mind was made up. He called the partner who had hired him for Wilmer, Cutler, and Pickering and told him he'd changed his mind. The partner made it plain that he regarded the young man at the other end of the line as a naive fool. Colin didn't care. In July, he went to work as an assistant to the mayor. For the first time in months, he felt that life held some purpose. He was confronting society's critical issue, nothing less than the American dilemma itself.
5. Twyman.
About the last of August came in a Dutch man of war that sold us 20 niggers. John Rolfe, a Virginia colonist, recorded laconically in 1619. The first blacks to enter an English settlement in the New World, their arrival marked the start of American slavery. The niggers were landed at Old Point Comfort, a sandy spit which divides the James River from the broad sweep of the Chesapeake Bay. Later, the point was incorporated into Hampton, the village to which the English settlers repaired after they abandoned Jamestown in 1610. Over the next two centuries, Hampton became an unusual antebellum community, combining small-town intimacy with the refinement of Tidewater planter society. Living side by side for 250 years, master and slave reached a rough accommodation. Laws against teaching slaves to read and write were widely ignored. Many whites permitted their slaves to hire themselves out to factories or artisans, returning a fixed payment to their masters. But the Civil War put Hampton in immediate jeopardy. By then, on Old Point Comfort, reared Fortress Monroe, a powerful Union bastion manned by 6,000 Northern troops. In May 1861, command of the fort was assumed by Major General Benjamin Butler, later governor of Massachusetts and a great favorite of Charlestown's Irish. Butler confronted a difficult situation. Only weeks after his arrival, and 18 months before the Emancipation Proclamation, three slaves belonging to Colonel Charles Mallory of the Virginia Militia escaped to the fort, claiming that their master wanted them to work on Confederate fortifications in North Carolina. Needing laborers of his own, Butler granted the Negroes asylum. When Colonel Mallory protested, invoking the Fugitive Slave Act, which required that slaves be returned to their rightful owners, Butler said he was seizing the slaves as contraband of war. Butler's dictum raced through Hampton. Within days, he was besieged by hundreds more contraband seeking refuge at what they called Fort Freedom. Slaveholders, realizing that they could no longer maintain their property in the shadow of the Union fortification, fled north with their valued chattel. Among the departing slaves were the Jenkinses, George and Amy, both in their mid-70s, their son, Frederick, and his wife, Charlotte, and their grandchildren, James, Amanda, and Frederick Jr., who in early 1861 set sail with their masters for Nova Scotia. Although 850 miles to the north, the peninsula was a logical refuge for Virginians. Trading ships had long shuttled between Nova Scotian and Tidewater ports. Moreover, though Canada had for many years been a haven for runaway slaves, it served southern whites, too, as a shelter from the approaching apocalypse. Slavery had been abolished in Canada,
but slaveholders could import their chattel as servants. In the months just before the Civil War, hundreds of Southern whites and their Negroes arrived in Canada. Landing on the Bay of Fundy, the Jenkinses and their masters soon settled 13 miles to the south in the village of West Nicktaw, which was populated by New Englanders who had arrived there soon after the British expelled the original French settlers. By 1861, West Nicktaw was a tiny farming community, its hills dotted with orchards which produced apples for export to Boston, New York, even London. The Jenkinses were the only black family in town. Elsewhere in the Annapolis Valley were remnants of earlier waves of black immigration, loyalist blacks who had gone over to the British cause during the Revolution and were later settled in Nova Scotia, the slaves of American Tories brought by their masters to the peninsula, and Negroes who had served in British units during the War of 1812. But these Negroes had clung together in tight little settlements. While remaining in the service of their masters, the Jenkinses didn't feel free to join one of these black enclaves. Even after the master-servant relationship dissolved, they stayed on in West Nicktaw, doing odd jobs for white farmers and orchardmen, butchering pigs, threshing buckwheat, sawing wood, splitting birches for the hoops on apple barrels. At first, they lived on the Nicktaw Road next door to the two-room schoolhouse, where the Jenkins children were the only blacks. In class, they were regarded as quaint curiosities, the white kids chanting, "Thick lips, flat nose, on the head the wool grows." The family attended the Nicktaw United Baptist Church, where they were assigned a special pew on the side aisle. Soon after George Jenkins died at 91, his family moved from the schoolhouse site to the Middle Road, a desolate tract where the village's poorest residents lived in tar paper shacks. But they retained a sense of their own uniqueness, their special relationship with white folks. They never mixed with the blacks of North Street in Middleton, a settlement barely 4 miles away. North Street was called the Bog, partly because it was built on swampy ground, partly because it was the home of indigent 1812 refugees known for their drinking and other low behavior. Charlotte Jenkins would warn her kids, "Stay away from those niggers in the bog." It was a strange life. Embraced by neither whites nor blacks, they occupied a sort of racial no man's land in which conventional allegiances were suspended. By 1885, Frederick Jenkins Jr., then 25, was growing restless. He had become a lumberman, cutting white ash, black birch, and rock maples, then riding the logs down the river to a sawmill in the valley. But there wasn't much money in that, and other opportunities were scant. Black Nova Scotians had begun migrating to New England, where jobs were more plentiful, and when Frederick heard of a job with a Massachusetts lumber company, he packed his meager belongings and took the overnight ferry to Boston. When the job fell through, he worked successively at a tannery, a coal yard, and an asphalt company, while moonlighting as a janitor and rag merchant. Eventually, he settled in Lower Roxbury, where he married Rachel Baker, a recent migrant from Virginia. In 1905, their only child, Helen, was born. The Jenkinses lived in Lower Roxbury for more than 30 years, 19 of them on Flag Street. Predominantly Irish and Italian, their block had only a smattering of blacks, and the races lived side by side with little tension. On warm summer nights, the neighbors gathered on someone's front stoop to drink beer and play cards. Maintaining his family's tradition of association with whites, Frederick Jenkins exchanged visits with two Scottish families from Nova Scotia and often played the fiddle at Irish wakes. Helen was raised on sausage and sweet pastries, which her mother sent her to buy at the Italian markets on Northampton Street. Only one childhood incident marred her sense of well-being. In 1923, her cousin Moses Baker was temporarily stationed as a seaman at the Charlestown Navy Yard. One night, walking the Charlestown waterfront on his way back to base, Moses was assaulted by several men and beaten so badly he spent weeks in the hospital and eventually had a kidney removed. Helen, then 18, was horrified and resolved to stay away from Charlestown. After graduating from the High School of Practical Arts in 1925, she went to work for the Marshalls, a Yankee family who lived in a big house in Jamaica Plain. She never regarded herself as a maid, more as a companion and helper. In the summers, Helen accompanied the family to their house in New Hampshire, where she had her own room all through the hot weather. They were good to her. One Sunday in 1930, when Helen was 25, she was walking down Camden Street, coming home from the Zion Methodist Church, when someone hailed her from across the street. It was Jim, the laundryman, but Helen noticed he had another man with him, a nice-looking fellow. So she said, "You come over here to talk with me and leave your friend over there?" "Well, he's single, so I didn't bring him over," Jim said. It wasn't considered proper for single men and women to meet in such circumstances. But later that afternoon, Jim came by the house and introduced Helen to his friend Quinny Walker, who had found his way to Boston by a very different route from the one the Jenkinses had taken. If Hampton's slaves enjoyed certain dispensations, 70 miles upriver at Richmond, many blacks were at least nominally free. Many Virginians, taking the rhetoric of independence with utmost seriousness, had recognized the irony of fighting for freedom while denying it to others. The glorious and ever-memorable revolution can be justified on no other principles but what do plead with still greater force for the emancipation of our slaves, said a petition from Hanover County in 1785. Although Thomas Jefferson retained 150 slaves, many of his neighbors invoked his ringing phrases to justify the liberation of thousands of their own chattel between 1785 and 1800. But soon this fervor cooled. After a number of free Negroes joined Gabriel Prosser's and Nat Turner's rebellions, they were denounced as degraded, profligate, vicious, turbulent, and discontented persons whose locomotive habits fit them for a dangerous agency in schemes wild and visionary. Although they continued to work as tobacco processors, coal miners, iron forgers, and draymen, the legislature imposed stern new restrictions on their religious and educational activities, and vigilante bands made sure that they knew the penalty for violating such regulations. Free blacks had to remain alert for another breed of freebooter, the kidnapper. For, with the invention of the cotton gin in 1793, cotton fever had seized the Deep South, sharply raising the price of slaves needed to pick the crop. By the 1830s, Virginia's depleted soil was no longer suitable for large-scale cotton production, and slaves themselves became the state's most valuable crop. Pressed by creditors, many old families turned their plantations into giant breeding farms, until the state resembled one grand menagerie where men are reared for the market like oxen for the shambles. Between 1830 and 1840, no fewer than 117,000 slaves were sold into other states. Virginia Negroes were in particular demand along the frontiers of Georgia and Mississippi, where every rustic seemed to hanker after a Virginia-bred black as his coachman, a Virginia slave as his lady's maid. Bands of kidnappers roamed the state, seizing free Negroes and selling them into slavery in the Deep South. Richmond's 2,000 free Negroes, feared, despised, and now particularly vulnerable, were prime targets for such raiders. Late in November 1833, an 8-year-old girl named Fanny, the daughter of a free black man and a Cherokee Indian woman, was playing on the dusty roadway in front of her Richmond home when she heard the strains of a popular tune drifting down the street. Looking up, she saw a pair of horses drawing a flatbed wagon in which a band of white musicians were scraping on fiddles and tooting on horns. As the wagon drew abreast of her house, it stopped. The driver looked down and asked if she wanted a ride. Fanny hesitated. Her mother had warned her about going off with strange whites, but the tune was so enchanting that Fanny couldn't resist. She hopped up beside the driver, and the wagon clattered off down the street. One can only imagine what Fanny must have felt when she realized some hours later that the musicians were kidnappers, part of a gang which had been snatching Negro children off Richmond's streets. But the loss of a freedom then enjoyed by barely 180,000 blacks among 2.5 million in the slave states must have brought with it a special sense of anguish. That day could only have bequeathed a grievance against white people which would linger in Fanny's family for generations to come. Fanny and the other captives were formed into a coffle, a long train of slaves fastened together for the march south. The women and girls were tied to one another by ropes wound like halters around their necks, while the men and boys wore iron collars linked by a thick chain, their wrists cuffed behind their backs. The white drivers rode on horseback alongside, carrying whips which they cracked in the air whenever the coffle lagged. The slaves walked 25 miles a day, pausing in the morning and evening for meals of corn mush and boiled herring. At the day's end, still wearing their shackles, they lay down by the roadside to sleep. After 2 weeks, Fanny's coffle reached Augusta, a center of the slave trade for the Savannah River Basin. Augusta held its major auction on the first day of every month, when the slaves were led through the crowded streets to the city market, a gleaming white structure topped by a gold cupola. Its ground floor, which opened to the street through rows of Doric columns, was jammed with butcher stalls and fruit stands. In the rear, farmers sold cows, horses, and pigs. Out front stood a large wooden slave block, to which, on auction days, the bell in the clock tower summoned a throng of prosperous planters, small farmers, overseers, commission agents, hackmen, gamblers, and blacklegs. In the crowd that day in early 1834 was Job Gresham, a middle-aged planter from nearby Burke County who had come to the city to stock up on provisions. His wife had long wanted a lady's maid, and when he spotted little Fanny on the block, he resolved to take her home as a surprise. Job Gresham was a native Virginian, too, but by age 24 he'd found his way to Burke County, where he married into a pioneer family. The colonists who had settled that portion of eastern Georgia in the 1740s were drawn by its astonishingly rich soil, ideally suited to the southern plantation system. "I don't know exactly what the good Lord was thinking when he made Burke County," one early planter said, "but I believe he was thinking about cotton." But while King Cotton thrived in Burke's intense heat, white men working the fields suffered wasting and tormenting fluxes, most excruciating colics. To elude these fevers, Burke's planters worked out a pleasing accommodation to the climate. Turning the cultivation of their cotton lands over to resident overseers, they arranged to spend much of the year just across the line in Richmond County. There, on a high plateau covered with oak and pine, they founded a resort colony called Brothersville, replete with gleaming bungalows, lush lawns, and picnic grounds. Job Gresham had a house in Brothersville, where he stayed from June through October, returning to his plantation on Briar Creek in November and remaining through the spring planting. As the housemaid, Fanny accompanied the family wherever it went, first cleaning, washing dishes, and polishing silver, later cooking and waiting on table. Several years after she came to the Greshams, she accepted the attentions of a field slave named Jack Benefield, 5 years her elder. One spring, they were married in the traditional slave wedding ceremony, jumping over a broom. Since Fanny was a house slave and Jack a field slave, they held different social positions on the plantation. Normally, Jack would have lived with the other field hands in an Indian-style lean-to, but since he was married to Fanny, the master gave them permission to share one of the little huts behind the big house. When Job Gresham died in 1846, his slaves were divided between his two sons. John Jones, then practicing law in Macon, where he twice served as mayor of the city, and Edmund Bine, who remained at home to run the family estate. John received 13 blacks. Edmund took 22, among them Fanny and Jack Benefield. By 1860, Edmund owned 99 slaves, ranking him 10th in the county. He and his wife, Sarah, treated their slaves with some consideration. But like his father, Edmund spent much of his time in the pine-scented cool of Brothersville, leaving personal supervision of the plantation to his overseer, Henry Ward. Ward was a hard man who drove the slaves relentlessly, and his wife was even harder. Once, when a cook burned the biscuits, Mrs. Ward made her strip to the waist and, as Fanny watched in horror, beat her with a willow branch until the blood ran down her back. As war drew near, Edmund played a growing role in the county's affairs. One of three delegates from Burke to Georgia's secession convention, He sat down in his hotel room at Milledgeville on January 9, 1861, and wrote his wife, "This day will be long remembered by Georgia. We have passed the ordinance of secession by a vote of 208-89. The ordinance will be signed on Monday at 12 o'clock, and now, while I am writing, the cannon is firing, the bells are ringing, and every other demonstration of joy you can conceive of is going on." Once the fighting began, the Greshams did their part. At age 52, Edmund was too old for active duty, but both his sons saw service. After the Confederacy's capitulation in April 1865, Augusta's ex-slaves petitioned the government for some means of marking their emancipation. Authorities scheduled a massive parade on July 4th, the date most closely identified with American freedom. Before dawn that day, thousands of former slaves from surrounding counties, Fanny and Jack Benefield among them, set out on foot for Augusta. Whites retreated behind shuttered windows, leaving the streets to the Negroes, who lined the parade route 10 deep. At noon, a detachment of the 33rd United States Colored Troops proudly stepped off, leading a procession of 4,000 wildly exultant Negroes. Later, some 10,000 blacks assembled before the city market, where 31 years before Fanny had been auctioned on the slave block, to hear the Reverend James Lynch deliver his liberation sermon. In those first months after the war, thousands of freed slaves descended on Waynesboro and Augusta to agitate for change. To Fanny and Jack Benefield, emancipation meant sweet revenge on their overseer, Henry Ward, and especially on his terrible wife. When Union soldiers heard about Mrs. Ward, they made her dance the jig all the way to Waynesboro, more than 12 miles. On the outskirts of town, she collapsed in the dusty road. With the Wards gone, Edmund and Sarah Gresham spent more time at the home place, bringing their more benevolent style to the fields. The Freedmen's Bureau, charged with protecting the rights of freed slaves, established a contract system with minimum wages, stipulated rations, and sick time. Able-bodied males like Jack received $8 a month, a woman hand like Fanny, $4. But the relationship between employers and laborers hadn't changed greatly from pre-war days. The hands still lived in the slave quarters, drew rations from the smokehouse, worked in gangs under white managers. The Greshams provided virtually everything Fanny and Jack needed for their daily lives, subtracting the value of those goods and services from their wages. $3 for a pair of shoes, 75 cents for two plugs of tobacco, 25 cents for a dose of castor oil. At month's end, most hands had little, if anything, coming to them. So long as the freedman accepted his new lot, his life was bearable. But if he objected, arguing that this wasn't the emancipation they'd been promised, retribution could be swift and sure. In 1866, flogging, as in slave days, was common in Burke. Jack Benefield's back, his grandson recalls, looked like a washboard from all the beatings he'd taken. By March 1868, the Ku Klux Klan was active in the county. In a single month that spring, three freedmen were shot to death by whites. For the Greshams, Reconstruction was a trying period. It took time to accommodate themselves to the new realities. When John Jones Gresham married one of the county's belles, his uncle wrote from Macon, "I am sorry that circumstances are such that I cannot give him a Negro, but I must do the next best thing left, that is, give him a mule." Of all the Greshams, young Job, a grandson of the original Job Gresham, was the most capable. Mustered out of the Georgia Volunteers at Appomattox, he walked the 400 miles back to Burke County, where he took over a plantation which had belonged to a distant cousin named William Bine. It was a pleasant spread, with 900 acres of cotton land, an orchard, a smokehouse, and an iron foundry, a big place that needed more than Bine's hands to farm it. After Edmund Gresham died in 1872, his widow sent over four men to help her son, among them Jack Benefield. Jack and Fanny Benefield had one child, Cornelia, who married Frederick Walker, one of Edmund Gresham's slaves. By 1880, Fred had joined Jack on Job Gresham's place. Each tilled a plow, about 25 acres of cotton land, a few more for corn and vegetables, for which they paid Job a bale of cotton. They relied heavily on their wives and children to hoe and weed the fields, then pick the cotton in the fall, harvesting about 10 bales a year. With prices averaging $50 a bale, they earned about $500 a year. But they didn't keep much of it. Off the top came the bale each owed Job. Moreover, Job provided them with seed, implements, and food to be paid for, with substantial interest, after the harvest. Once those debts were paid, the Benefields and Walkers had just enough to squeak by on until it was planting time again. In 1881, Jack Benefield had a $50 mule, $25 worth of farm tools, and $10 in household furniture, a net worth of $85. Later, they got their credit from merchants in nearby Keysville, who had a wider range of goods than Job could provide, but who squeezed every cent of interest they could out of the farmers. If a tenant failed to pay his debts, the landlord or merchant would seize his crop, his meager belongings, even his dog or cat. The desperate farmer often tried to hide a few vegetables to feed his family. Once Sol Walker, Fred's brother, was beaten severely by his landlord for attempting to conceal some corn inside his mattress. Job's Negroes sought solace from the hardships of this world at the Antioch Baptist Church. The Benefields and Walkers were all members of Antioch, and Sol Walker was long one of its deacons. The Reverend Seaborn Jones, its pastor for 50 years, was a preacher of great passion and greater volume, whose Sunday morning sermons, it was said, could be heard half a mile away. And everybody up and down the old Gresham Highway could hear Jake Mitchell, the church drummer, as he marched by banging the drum to proclaim the death of an Antioch member. One morning in 1892, Jake banged his drum for old Jack Benefield, dead at 72. Fanny lived nearly half a century longer, dying in 1933 at the age of 108, when she was buried in the Gresham Cemetery a few feet from her first master, Job Gresham. By the time of Jack's death, Cornelia and Frederick Walker had 9 children of their own, with whom they lived in a 2-room, tin-roofed shack made of logs with gaping chinks through which the wind whistled. Fanny and Jack Benefield had never learned to read or write. Georgia law before the Civil War prescribed a stiff fine for anyone caught educating a slave, and Cornelia and Frederick had had only a year or two of grade school. The Walker children didn't do much better. They went to the all-black Spring Hill School, where they received the rudiments of learning, but most of them left well before the 8th grade to join their parents in the fields. Soon, however, those fields were ravaged by the boll weevil. As late as 1918, Burke County had produced a record 70,877 bales of cotton. By 1921, production had plummeted to 14,386 bales. White planters, who had once bet a dozen bales on a poker hand, were lucky to harvest that many from their blasted land. And black tenant farmers, with no resources to fall back on, were devastated. In 1922, the Waynesboro Women's Club, chaired by Mrs. Orrin Gresham, Job's niece, launched a campaign to assist needy children suffering from the winter cold. Appealing for sweaters, coats, and shoes, she said, "This is not only to supply a need, but to let these people realize we mean to see them through." But Burke's Negroes had little faith in their former masters. In 1922 alone, 5,000 of the county's 24,775 blacks departed, joining a massive flood of Negroes streaming north. Many who boarded the Dixie Flyer or the Southland in Augusta disembarked in Baltimore, Philadelphia, and New York, but others stayed aboard until their train reached Boston. Though wages were lower there than in the mid-Atlantic cities, there was something about Boston that drew Southern Negroes. It was from Boston that the abolitionists had issued their calls for a holy war against slavery. It was there that many blacks fled in the Underground Railway, relying on Bostonians to forward them to Canada. It was to Boston that David Walker, a North Carolina Negro, fled in 1825, and there that he issued his fiery pamphlet, Walker's Appeal. "Brethren, arise, arise, strike for your lives and liberties," which was widely distributed in Georgia. The image of Boston as a sanctuary was encouraged by black writers who, over the years, described it as a city of refuge, a place of light, life, and liberty. The one place in America where the black man is given equal justice, and even, euphorically, the paradise of the Negro. In 1923, Fanny Walker, Frederick and Cornelia's third oldest daughter, grew weary of wresting cotton from the wasted fields. Arriving in Boston, she sent word back that jobs were plentiful, wages nearly triple what they had been in Burke. That sounded good to her younger brother, Thomas Quinney Walker. Quinney had already done some roving. At the age of 17, he had gone to work for the Southern Bell Telephone Company, laying long lines through the Georgia swamps. 3 years later, just as the boll weevil hit Burke County, he returned to try his hand at tenant farming. One day, he went to the store seeking some corn and a hoe, but the shopkeepers refused to advance him the supplies, claiming that he owed them $40. That did it. Quinney gave his mule to his sister Sarah, packed his belongings in a worn cardboard suitcase, and boarded the Dixie Flyer. Years later, he would tell his daughter, the future Rachel Twyman, that when the train pulled into Boston's South Station that morning in 1925, he felt as if my life were starting all over again. After a year in which they saw each other every Sunday, Quinney and Helen Jenkins were married. And so a circle was completed. The wedding united two Virginia families who had begun barely 70 miles apart. Once they had been remarkably similar, slaves for hire in the urbane seaport, free blacks in the sophisticated capital. But the torturous route each family had traveled to Boston opened a chasm between them. One, transported to Nova Scotia, had found themselves the only blacks in a white village, proud of association with their neighbors, yet never quite accepted by them. The other, sold into slavery, had lived for 90 years in rural Georgia, surrounded by others of their race, fearing and resenting their white overlords. The marriage of an old Bostonian and an illiterate sharecropper proved an uneasy one, reflecting deep fissures in Boston's black community. Slavery was repugnant to the Puritans and was regarded by them with abhorrence, wrote William Sumner, a Massachusetts soldier historian, in 1858. On the eve of the Civil War, that was a convenient version of history, lending the North a moral superiority in the coming struggle. But it was bad history, at odds with the ample record of Massachusetts' dominant role in the slave trade. Boston was never quite so distinctive as it liked to pretend. Through the 18th century, Boston's sailing men provided Negroes to the West Indies and the Southern colonies. Slaves, bought in Africa for £5 sterling, brought from 30 to 90 pounds in the West Indies, a differential which laid the foundation for many New England fortunes. In comparison with the Southern colonies, there were never many slaves in Massachusetts, partly because the harsh climate and stony soil did not permit a plantation agriculture requiring numerous field hands. Yet, by the eve of the Revolution, 5,249 Negroes, most of them slaves, were counted in the colony. Still, Massachusetts' brand of slavery was distinctive, probably more benign than in any other colony. Following the Hebraic tradition passed down through the Old Testament, the Puritans regarded slaves as persons divinely committed to their stewardship. Usually referred to as servants rather than slaves, they were often treated as members of the family in which they lived. A visitor in 1704 complained that New England masters were too indulgent to their slaves, suffering too great familiarity from them, permitting you to sit at table and eat with them, as they say to save time, and into the dish goes the black hoof as freely as the white hand. Since salvation required a knowledge of the Bible, many masters even taught their slaves to read and write. The legal status of slaves in New England was somewhere between that of Southern plantation slaves and that of indentured servants. They could acquire, hold, and transfer property. They were entitled to a trial by jury. Most important, they could sue whites and could carry their suits on appeal to the highest courts in the colony. By the mid-18th century, slaves were taking advantage of that right, bringing civil suits for their freedom, arguing that slavery was contrary to ye laws of nature. such entreaties eventually reached the Puritan conscience. Like Virginians, many Massachusetts citizens perceived the contradictions between their own struggle against Britain and their enslavement of others. Abigail Adams, in a letter to her husband, John, wrote, "It always appeared a most iniquitous scheme to me to fight ourselves for what we are daily robbing and plundering from those who have as good a right to freedom as we have." Once the colonies won their independence, the Massachusetts Constitutional Convention adopted a Declaration of Rights, holding that all men are born free and equal. But slavery persisted. Not until 1783 did the state's Chief Justice declare it unconstitutional. Although conscience played a role in all this, more practical considerations were also involved. As John Adams noted, "The common people would not suffer the labor by which alone they could obtain a subsistence to be done by slaves. If the gentlemen had been permitted to hold slaves, the common people would have put the Negroes to death, and their masters too, perhaps." Unlike Southern slaves, who were overwhelmingly cultivators of cotton, rice, and tobacco, those in Massachusetts had been employed in a wide variety of crafts, as printers, blacksmiths, tailors, ship's carpenters, coopers, masons, rope makers, or sailors. But with the end of slavery in the state, white artisans largely reclaimed those jobs, and by the early 19th century, Negroes were heavily concentrated in service positions. At first, most blacks lived along the wharves of the North End, a quarter known as New Guinea. Later, they edged into the West End and onto adjacent Beacon Hill. Since many Negroes were servants to the wealthy whites who lived on the hill's south side, they settled in the crowded alleys on the reverse slope, which came to be known as Nigger Hill. It was there, in the African Meeting House, Boston's first black church, that William Lloyd Garrison and 11 other white men founded the New England Anti-Slavery Society and proclaimed two goals: the eradication of Southern bondage and of Northern discrimination. Although the former struggle took precedence, Garrison and other Boston abolitionists worked to ameliorate the lot of Boston's blacks side by side with such Negro leaders as Frederick Douglass and Lewis Hayton. One of their principal objectives was the integration of Boston's public schools. The city's school system had been segregated since 1798. In 1849, a black parent, Benjamin Roberts, brought suit against the city in the name of his daughter Sarah, seeking reintegration of the schools. Arguing Roberts' case before the Supreme Judicial Court, Charles Sumner said, "A school exclusively devoted to one class must differ essentially in its spirit and character from the public school known to the law, where all classes meet together in equality. It is a mockery to call it an equivalent." But Chief Justice Lemuel Shaw disagreed, ruling that the segregated schools did not deny Negroes equal protection of the law. Justice Shaw's ruling, the separate but equal doctrine, was to have a profound effect on the nation's history. The Roberts case was the chief precedent cited by the Supreme Court when it enshrined that doctrine in Plessy v. Ferguson, 1896, and thus the genesis of the legal principle which was to govern the country's race relations until 1954. Not in Boston, however. Spurned by the courts, black parents, supported by abolitionists of both races, carried their fight into the political arena. In 1855, the Massachusetts legislature passed a bill prohibiting segregated schools. It was the first of several notable victories achieved by the same coalition in the decades before the Civil War, among them lifting the ban on interracial marriages, adding Negroes to the jury rolls, and abandoning segregated seating on the state's railroad cars. By the eve of the Civil War, Massachusetts Negroes had achieved a fair measure of political and civil rights. Although their economic position was precarious and they were excluded from most social circles, they were probably more secure than their counterparts elsewhere in the nation. This progress prompted the New York Herald to lament, "Now the blood of the Winthrops, the Otises, the Lymans, the Endicotts, and the Elliots is in a fair way to be amalgamated with the Sambos, the Catos, and the Pompeys. The North is to be Africanized. Amalgamation has commenced. New England heads the column. God save the Commonwealth of Massachusetts."
The war itself quickened the sympathies of Boston's whites for their black fellow citizens. On May 28, 1863, thousands of Bostonians gathered to watch Colonel Robert Gould Shaw, a young Yankee aristocrat, lead his 54th Massachusetts Volunteer Infantry, the first Northern Black Regiment in the Civil War, through the city streets to Battery Wharf, where they embarked for South Carolina. Scarcely 2 months later, Shaw and several hundred of his Negro soldiers died together in an assault on Fort Wagner. Their common martyrdom helped cast a glow of brotherhood over the city's race relations. When a monument to them was dedicated at the crest of Beacon Hill, the philosopher William James declaimed, "There on foot go the dark outcasts. There on horseback among them, in his very habit as he lived, sits the blue-eyed child of fortune, upon whose happy youth every divinity has smiled." Onward they moved together, a single resolution kindled in their eyes and animating their otherwise so different frames. Indeed, for a time, it appeared that Boston's whites and blacks might march together toward the common goals of a just and equal society. Within months of the surrender at Appomattox, Massachusetts broadened the legal immunities of its black citizens. After Negroes complained about racial discrimination at Boston's Globe Theater and the Brigham Restaurant, the legislators banned such discrimination in licensed inns, public meetings, and places of amusement, a prohibition which was eventually extended to all public accommodations. Gradually, blacks played a more prominent role in public life. In 1867, two were elected to the Massachusetts legislature, where they maintained at least one representative until the end of the century. With their concentration in the West End, Boston's Negroes elected at least one city councilman in every election between 1876 and 1895. But as Boston's blacks tasted the fruits of this golden era, their community was already being transformed by successive waves of freed slaves from the South. The first to arrive were some of General Butler's contraband from Hampton. Massachusetts officers had supervised these Negroes in the refugee camps which sprang up around Fort Monroe. When the Freedmen's Bureau sought to relocate them after the war, it looked first to New England because there was no region more desirable as a home for the Negro. Back came stacks of applications for colored girl servants, and over the next few years, nearly 2,000 ex-slaves were sent north as domestics for white families in the Boston area. For the next three decades, Tidewater, Virginia remained the principal source of black migrants to Boston. Most of the ex-slaves who settled in Boston in the first years after the war were urban, literate, semi-skilled, light-skinned Negroes or mulattoes, products of the relatively benevolent slave system of the Upper South. But even such comparative sophistication didn't assure these migrants a warm welcome in the black community. For Boston's Negroes, sheltered by extensive legal protection, succored by a few principled abolitionists, favored by a certain latitude in the city's public life, were intensely proud of their special relationship with whites. They did not take kindly to the influx of recently freed slaves who reminded them of the indelible stamp of servitude which lay on the brow of all black men in America. This pride in their heritage of freedom was, for some Boston blacks, a goad to action. Accustomed to dealing with whites on a plane of rough equality, such northern Negroes were determined to extend Boston's racial climate to the nation at large. The chief spokesman for this group of Boston radicals was William Monroe Trotter. Born with an unusually light complexion, raised in White Hyde Park, Trotter had graduated magna cum laude from Harvard and inherited a modest fortune of $20,000. He inherited as well the racial militancy his father had developed while fighting for equal pay in one of the two black regiments Massachusetts sent into the Civil War. Trotter's principal target was Booker T. Washington, the sire of Tuskegee. In almost every respect, Washington was Trotter's antithesis. Born a dark-skinned Southern slave, he derided high-flown intellectualism and emphasized practical, industrial education for blacks. To Trotter, Washington was the quintessence of the Southern Negro whose spirit had been crushed by slavery. For Bookerites, Trotter was a dangerous overreacher, a brave, roaring, make-believe lion.
This conflict came to a head on July 30, 1902, at the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church on Boston's Columbus Avenue. Some 2,000 spectators had gathered that night to hear Washington lecture on the dignity and beauty of labor. But before he could begin, one of Trotter's supporters scattered cayenne pepper on the stage. Fistfights broke out in the audience, and Trotter himself clambered onto a chair to read a list of 9 challenges. After Trotter was arrested, a Bookerite journal cried, "What is the matter with these Boston Negroes?" But the Boston riot became a landmark in American race relations, less because it deepened the rift between Trotter and Washington than because it persuaded W.E.B. Du Bois, another highly educated Massachusetts Negro, to break with Washington and found the more militant National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, with its first branch in Boston. The newly aggressive mood did not persist among Boston's black elite. Trotter had never represented the privileged community into which he was born. The further the abolitionist past receded into history, the less militant Boston's blacks grew. By the second decade of the 20th century, their leadership had fallen into the hands of some 30 black families known as the Black Brahmins. There was J.H. Lewis, a merchant tailor who kept a stable of racehorses, Gilbert Harris, New England's largest wig maker, and the poet William Stanley Braithwaite. Like the white Brahmins, writes one historian, they spent Friday afternoons at the symphony, vacationed at Newport or on the Cape, and lived in Beacon Hill apartments or in large brick homes in the South End. Filled with books, potted palms, dull-colored plants near the window, and antique furniture. Children learned their social graces at Mr. Papanti's dancing school. They generally belonged to white churches, rather than the Baptist and AME churches founded by blacks. Many summered at Oak Bluffs on Martha's Vineyard. So proud were they of their roots in the city, which Oliver Wendell Holmes had called the hub of the solar system, that they organized a society of the descendants of early New England Negroes, which had 24 members in 1903. Though the true black Brahmins were a tiny fraternity, their influence greatly exceeded their numbers. Aspiring to their status, thousands of Boston-born Negroes took on the Brahmins' complacency, their aloofness from social problems, their reluctance to participate in any movement that might set them apart from the white mainstream. By the turn of the century, whites as well as blacks were retreating from the race question. In the South, the end of Reconstruction was followed by the imposition of rigid segregation, underscored by Klan raids and lynchings. In Boston, the changes were slower and subtler, but even there, the passing of the abolitionist leadership and weariness with the old issue took their toll. Once Boston's cultural institutions and public accommodations had been open to all, now segregation became the order of the day. The nursing school of the Massachusetts General Hospital denied a black woman's application. The black editor Frederick Douglass was forcibly ejected from a first-class railroad car and compelled to take a seat in the Jim Crow car. As blacks were deserted by their old Yankee allies, they found little sympathy among the Irish, who had long resented the abolitionists' alliance with the Negro. Blacks and Irish competed for jobs, with the Irish gradually displacing Negroes in many traditional occupations. Some intermarriage took place, particularly between Irish maids and black servants, but the children of such unions found themselves spurned by both groups. For a time after the turn of the century, Mayor James Michael Curley hinted at an alliance of Irish and black workers against the Yankee codfish aristocracy, but even Curley proved a fickle ally. When Trotter spearheaded a protest against the showing of D.W. Griffith's Birth of a Nation, Curley overrode objections to the film's racial message and authorized its run. "Where is the valiant Jim Curley of old?" Trotter asked bitterly. "The friend of the people, lovable Jim Curley, whom we colored people supported for the mayoralty against the advice of our white friends. If this were an attack on the Irish race, he would find a way pretty quick to stop it." The alliance died aborning. White Bostonians, Irish and Yankees alike, were responding in part to the Southern ex-slaves who had flooded north in the decades since the Civil War, expanding Boston's black community from barely 2,280 in 1860 to nearly 14,000 in 1910. These late arrivals were likely to be dark-skinned field hands from rural Georgia or Alabama. Even W.E.B. Du Bois conceded in 1901, "As a whole, it is true that the average of culture and wealth and social efficiency is far lower among immigrants than natives." It was one thing for white Bostonians to attend the symphony with the Lewises or visit the Authors Club with William Stanley Braithwaite, quite another to brush shoulders with a former Georgia sharecropper. Whites recoiled, and gradually that recoil hardened into permanent withdrawal. To Boston-born blacks, the lesson was clear. The newcomers, soon dubbed homies from down home, were dragging them under, destroying their special relationship with whites. In 1912, a white social worker was strolling through a black neighborhood with Butler Wilson, a prominent black Brahmin and leader of the NAACP, arguing about the establishment of a settlement house for black youth. They passed a group of young Negroes playing craps. "What's to become of them?" the social worker asked. "Let them rot," snapped Wilson. As the homies swarmed into black neighborhoods, Boston's blacks began to disperse, hoping to put some distance between themselves and the interlopers. Even before the turn of the century, older Negro families began moving out of their traditional quarter on the back side of Beacon Hill, establishing themselves in the South End, Dorchester, or the more remote suburbs. Soon the South End became the principal landing place of the Southern migrants, for jobs were readily available there in the Boston and Albany railroad yards and the hotels of Copley Square. Many railroad porters and waiters settled in a narrow strip between the tracks and Columbus Avenue, within easy walking distance of Back Bay Station. One boarding house in the neighborhood catered exclusively to Southern-born waiters. Ebenezer Baptist Church, established to serve Southern fundamentalists, soon became known as the Jaybird Tabernacle because of the loud shouts of "Glory to God," which punctuated its services. And the Southern Diner on Columbus Avenue appealed to homey tastes with hush puppies and sweet potato pie. After World War I, another ingredient was added to the stew pot of black Boston: West Indians, particularly from Barbados and Jamaica. Highly motivated and hardworking, they came to Boston intending to make some quick money and then to go home. Many stayed on, but they continued to regard themselves as His Majesty's subjects and formed their own set of institutions: St. Cyprian's Episcopal Church, the Eureka Cooperative Bank, the Crispus Attucks Drum and Bugle Corps. West Indians were known in Boston as Black Jews and Monkey Chasers, but most often as Turks. By the 1920s, Boston's black community formed a triangle, with Brahmins, homies, and Turks all protecting their prerogatives and regarding each other with ill-disguised suspicion. This chronic fragmentation enfeebled the community, but there were other sources of weakness. The vaunted special relationship between the races, though short-lived and much exaggerated, seduced Negroes from the development of strong black institutions, which might have created a substantial middle class. For years, Boston's largest black business was Chisholm's Funeral Home. Then there was the community's size. Throughout the 19th century, blacks never exceeded 2% of the city, and even by 1970, they had reached only 16.3%. compared with Washington's 71% or Detroit's 43%. Boston blacks lacked the critical mass necessary for effective political or social action. This became particularly important in 1949, when the city charter was amended to replace ward-based elections with an at-large system. With the black community unable to muster enough votes citywide, only one Negro, Tom Atkins, was elected to the city council over the next quarter century. Finally, the community had no historic center to provide a sense of continuity and cohesion. Boston Negroes have always lived in segregated space, but that space has shifted steadily from north to south. There has never been a place where Boston's blacks could say with certainty, "This is what we are. This is where we make our stand." By the mid-20th century, black Boston had three separate centers: in town, crosstown, and the Hill. The Hill was the latest refuge of the Brahmins and their imitators.
It had been a Jewish neighborhood until the 1930s, when upwardly mobile Negroes seeking better housing leapfrogged over a resistant Irish community and settled on the slopes leading to the green of Franklin Park. By the 40s, they were firmly established in the big Victorian houses on the tree-shaded side streets off Humboldt Avenue. It was there, in the summer of 1940, that Malcolm Little, later Malcolm X, moved in with his sister Ella. He found it a snooty black neighborhood, whose residents prided themselves on being incomparably more cultivated, dignified, and better off than their black brethren down in the ghetto. Crosstown, back in the South End, was the Great Black Way, Black Broadway, or to its denizens, simply the Avenue. Its red-hot center was the intersection of Massachusetts and Columbus Avenues, where jazz and blues blared from the open doorways of the Hi-Hat, the Wigwam, Kelly's, Wally's, Paradise, and the Big M. And there were seedier establishments, gin mills like Hardy's or the 411 Lounge, where the three biggest pimps in town hung out with their stables. The high rollers parked their long cars at the curb, searching the sidewalk for the litany of crosstown pleasures: dope, booze, the numbers, the horses, and high yellow women. In town was where the Walkers and the Jenkinses before them lived, a largely working-class neighborhood embracing Lower Roxbury and the outer South End. The narrow side streets, Kendall, Hammond, Davenport, Ball, Flag, were predominantly black, though still with a liberal admixture of Irish, Italians, and Jews. On the major thoroughfares were the offices of the black doctors and lawyers, the undertakers, barbershops and hairdressers, and the best restaurants: Slade's Barbecue, where chickens roasted tantalizingly in the front window, and Estelle's, where a customer could munch ribs and ogle the black celebrities. Shortly after Helen Jenkins and Quinnie Walker were married in 1931, they moved into a little row house on Davenport Street in the heart of Lower Roxbury, a shabby house on a shabby street. Quinnie worked steadily, first at the P.H. Graham Waste Paper Company, hauling cardboard boxes from the downtown department stores, then, during the Depression, on several WPA construction projects. But there was never enough money to go around, particularly after the Walkers started having children, 8 in all, beginning with Rachel in 1934. They were poor, at times desperately poor, but somehow they managed. From his sharecropping days, Quinnie knew how to draw food from the earth. In their backyard, he planted a vegetable garden where he grew collard greens, wax beans, cucumbers, and tomatoes. When the produce was ripe, he wrapped it first in waxed paper, then in brown paper, twisting it in a special way to keep out the air. Then, after the first frost hit, he stored the packages in barrels sunk deep in the frozen earth, so the family had greens all winter long. In those first years, the marriage seemed to work, but gradually the gulf between the Bostonian and the Georgia homie grew wider. Between 1940 and 1960, Boston's black population mushroomed from 23,675 to 63,165. Nearly tripling in 20 years what it had taken three centuries to build. Most of the newcomers were Cotton Belt Southerners, some arriving during the war to work in military facilities or industry, others surging north in the post-war boom. For many Boston blacks, this latest wave of Southern immigration was devastating, the final liquidation of their special relationship. In the narrow alleys of InTown, a remnant of old Bostonians struggled to retain some shred of that distinctiveness. Sometimes they were driven to extreme measures. One woman who grew up in Lower Roxbury recalls how outraged her mother was when an Alabama family moved next door and began hanging its laundry on the front porch. Her mother went over and explained, "That's not the way we do things here. We put our laundry in the backyard." When the Alabama woman told her to mind her own business, the Bostonian instructed her children to spatter the laundry with mud. They had to do it three times before the newcomer got the message and moved her wash to the rear. This battle of religion and class was fought out within the Walker household. Helen felt that she'd married beneath her. Quinnie, who had quit school in the fifth grade, could neither read nor write. He was not without talents. A natural mechanic,
He could fix your lawnmower or water pump, and people said he could hear a car go by 2 blocks away and tell what was wrong with it. But such skills carried little weight with Bostonians like his wife, who regarded him as a Georgia farm boy. Quinny thought Helen was uppity. He sensed that she felt superior to him because her folks had been house niggers while his had been field niggers, and he couldn't stand her house nigger ways. He didn't understand why she had to set the table every day with forks, knives, and spoons. Down where he came from, people weren't afraid to pick up good food in their hands. He ridiculed her because she didn't know how to clean a fish or pluck a chicken. Simple jobs for any 8-year-old Burke County girl. Much of the conflict focused on the Fourth Methodist Church, just down Shawmut Avenue. Although its pastors and membership were black, it was part of the overwhelmingly white Methodist Episcopal Church, and thus gained some of the traditional prestige Boston blacks attached to such churches. A devout member, Helen served on several of the church's committees while sending her children to its Sunday school. Quinny, though nominally a Baptist, had little use for religion. For a few years, he reluctantly joined Helen at Fourth Methodist, yet soon he stopped going and did whatever he could to prevent her from attending that fancy white folks' church. As the atmosphere at home deteriorated, Quinny spent most of his time playing whist at the Independent Social Club or lounging on orange crates with the other neighborhood men outside Dolly Bolt's Tropical Variety Store. Injured in an accident on a WPA project, he received some insurance money and promptly spent it on a secondhand Cadillac, in which he loved to tool up and down the avenue. A spiffy dresser, he wore dazzling white shoes, which he polished every day. Quinny also savored his whiskey. Old Granddad gulped straight from a big juice jar, and he relished his women. The family knew he was running around, often spotting him with some new girlfriend coming out of a crosstown bar. A massive dude, his 6-foot frame carried 250 pounds, Quinny could be a tyrant at home. When he thought it was time for guests to leave, he would go downstairs and pull all the fuses out of the box. He refused to buy Helen clothes, so she couldn't go out. When he went to work in the morning, he often turned the furnace off and locked the basement door, leaving Helen and the children to shiver in a frigid house. Not surprisingly, the Walker kids were caught between their mother's Brahmin reserve and their father's street savvy. On most issues, Rachel took her mother's side, but the ferocity with which she defended it owed not a little to her father's style. Once, when she saw one of Quinny's women loading up her father's Cadillac outside Folsom's Market, she grabbed the groceries and flung them all over the parking lot. And one particularly cold day, Rachel unscrewed the hasp on the basement door and, while her terrified mother begged her not to, went down and turned on the furnace. This set off a terrible row, during which Quinny warned his rebellious daughter not to mess with the furnace again, and Rachel said she'd mess with it any time she liked, and the only way Quinny could stop her was to carry the damn thing around on his back. During World War II, Quinny got a job at the Charlestown Navy Yard. Remembering what had happened to their cousin Moses Baker, the family was apprehensive. But every day, Quinny and two black co-workers rode the L to City Square and walked along the wharves to the yard. Townie heads would turn, but nobody ever bothered them. After the war, he went to work for the Begsford Construction Company, where he made good money. But Helen and the children didn't see much of it. When the kids wanted a dime for ice cream or candy, he'd say, "I can't afford to make the Jew rich." Most Roxbury stores were Jewish-owned. Eventually, Helen went to work as a stitcher at the Goddess Bra Factory to help pay the bills, but even that wasn't enough. In 1960, she got a court order requiring him to pay her $50 a week, which he did only sporadically. In October 1962, Helen left him and moved in with her second daughter, Alva. After all those years of wrangling, Quinny, then 58, was at a loss without his wife. He moved across the street to a smaller house where he was desperately lonely. When he asked some of his children if he could move in with them, they put him off. On February 5, 1963, he was standing on the platform of the Northampton Street L station during the evening rush hour. As a train roared in, Quinny stuck his head directly in its path and suffered a fractured skull.
He underwent delicate brain surgery, but died the next day. Although police called it an accident, some of Quinney's children, Rachel among them, believed it was suicide. Long before her father's death, Rachel had been having troubles of her own. In her third year at Brandeis Vocational High School, she'd grown bored with the dreary courses in sewing, typing, and office practice, so she hadn't put up much resistance when her father insisted that she quit school to help support the family. She took a job at Mac's Variety Store, where the owners trusted her so completely that they often went south and left the store in her teenage hands. At 19, Rachel left home for good, taking a room with a family friend and keeping time with Eddie Jones, a burly trucker who drove giant rigs on interstate runs to California and Arizona. In quick succession, she bore two of his children, Richard in 1954 and George in 1955. For a time, Eddie helped support his sons, but he never lived with Rachel, and gradually they drifted apart. Soon she met another man, a charming Alabamian with a Nike missile unit in suburban Squantum, and in July 1957, Rachel and Sergeant Haywood Twyman were married. When Haywood overstayed his leave, he was bumped to corporal, an ominous start to a marriage that soon went awry. For Rachel had largely recapitulated her mother's mismatch. Like Helen, she was proud of her roots in Boston, of her associations with whites. She cherished childhood memories of Lower Roxbury's ethnic hodgepodge, of Catholic holidays when Italian neighbors would invite her in for homemade wine and butter cake. She was nostalgic for that golden era of racial harmony when people were people, whether they were black or white or whatever. Soon after her marriage, she sought out a six-room apartment on Dewey Street, two-thirds of the way from in-town toward the hill, in a neighborhood still largely white. Haywood, on the other hand, was not unlike Quinney, a product of the Cotton Belt who felt ill at ease with the gentility of old Bostonians. At first, he was regarded as a prime catch, an army sergeant with a technical skill and prospects for promotion. Jovial and friendly, he was good company, except when drinking. But as the years went by, he drank with increasing ferocity. As soon as he got his paycheck, off he would go on a binge, hitting all the bars along Massachusetts and Columbus Avenues. One Christmas, he was found wandering the streets in his underwear. In the meantime, he was saddling himself with family responsibilities. Four children came quickly: Frederick in 1958, Wayne in 1959, Cassandra in 1960, and young Rachel in 1961. With little money coming in from Haywood, Rachel went back to work, joining her mother for a time at Goddess Bra, later working as a packer at Schraft's Candy Factory in Charlestown, then as a maid for white families in the suburbs. With a child coming nearly every year, and often laid up with mysterious illnesses, Rachel couldn't take a steady job with a family. Instead, she did day work, shuttling back and forth by bus and subway to the comfortable Yankee Jewish suburb of Newton. This meant rising before dawn to reach the state employment office by 9 a.m., when the jobs were parceled out. The families Rachel worked for lived in big Victorian houses along Walnut Street. The brisk young housewives gave her the work they didn't want to do themselves, scrubbing bathtubs, cleaning toilets, scraping the grease out of ovens. Unlike her mother, who never regarded herself as a maid, Rachel knew just what she was and resented it bitterly. In June 1960, 3 months after Cassandra was born, Haywood stunned the family by announcing that he was leaving the army after 8 years. Rachel, Helen, and other relatives urged him to reconsider. His military allotments had kept the children fed even when he drank up the rest of his pay. But Haywood wanted out. Cousin Moses Baker chose that moment for one of his periodic visits to Boston. Retired from the Navy on a disability pension after the Charlestown beating, Cuz was a highly respected member of New Haven's black community, for years president of its NAACP chapter, a former butler to Yale professors. Some of the family found him pompous and self-important, but he was Rachel's favorite cousin, personifying the respectability she so badly craved. On his visits to Boston, he invariably stayed with her because only she would put up with his demands, that his plate and cup be warmed before each meal,
and his coffee served just so. For days before his arrival, Rachel scrubbed the house and prepared his favorite dishes. Haywood bitterly resented the great Cuz, grumbling, "He ain't nothing but a man, is he?" Cuz, in turn, openly disdained Haywood. The continuing debate over Haywood's decision to quit the army made this visit from Cuz an especially tense one. Haywood behaved well all week, but others could see he was building up a head of steam. The morning after Cuz had left, Haywood told Rachel that some friends were coming by to play cards, and he needed $10 to buy whiskey and beer. Rachel, who could get very deaf when she didn't want to hear someone, simply ignored him. Pulling on his pants, Haywood warned, "When I get dressed, you better have that $10. Rachel didn't respond. Exasperated, Haywood grabbed his wife and dragged her down the hallway, bellowing new threats at her while she shouted her defiance. But Rachel wrenched free, grabbed a pot of boiling water off the stove, and as Haywood bolted down the stairs, emptied it on his head. Howling in pain, he lurched back upstairs, pulling the soaked undershirt over his head. With it came great swatches of skin from his chest, shoulders, and face. Treated at the hospital for third-degree burns, Haywood came home, but Rachel wouldn't have him. "I'm sick," he appealed. "I don't care," she said. "I don't want you dying here. Get out and stay out." After a month, Rachel relented, but the relationship continued to deteriorate. In March 1961, Haywood walked out. Dependent on his $68 a week from Colonial Coal, out of work herself, with five young children to support, Rachel sought public assistance for the first time. The welfare department awarded her an emergency grant of $20. At the social worker's suggestion, she then swore out a non-support complaint against Haywood, and the court ordered him to give her his full salary every week, which he did until mid-May, when he was laid off. After a hospital stay in June, Rachel moved to her parents' house on Ball Street, taking her children with her. In July, she again went to the welfare office, sobbing and somewhat hysterical, saying that her youngest child, Cassandra, was ill. She had no money except for the few dollars her parents could spare and feared that if she returned to Dewey Street, Haywood would beat her. The social worker authorized general relief payments of $38.80 per week. 10 days later, a warrant was issued for Haywood's arrest for non-support. That August, Rachel obtained an uncontested separation from her husband, who was ordered to pay $40 a week in support of his family. Meanwhile, Rachel qualified for permanent aid to families with dependent children, with payments beginning at $257 a month. In September, she and the children moved back to Dewey Street, changing the lock to keep Haywood out. For a time, Haywood met his obligations, but in July 1962, he was laid off again. Late in August, he blew most of his $64 a week unemployment check on a drinking binge. With no money to feed her children, Rachel swore out another complaint against him, and this time the court sentenced Haywood to 6 months at the Deer Island Correctional Facility. The year before, Eddie Jones, father of Rachel's first two children, had spent several months at Deer Island for failing to support them and several children by another woman. Rachel insisted she never wanted to send either man to jail. All she wanted them to do was support the children they'd given her. But this is just what Haywood couldn't or wouldn't do. On his release from prison in February 1963, he told Rachel he'd learned his lesson and wanted to come home. She refused, saying she didn't want him in the house until he proved he had stopped drinking and could support the family. Getting a job at the Tillotson Rubber Company, he resumed support payments. Late at night, he would show up at Rachel's door, often with a bottle in his hand. To avoid trouble, she often let him in, then watched him fall asleep on the couch. But soon, the support payments stopped again. In November 1963, Haywood was sent back to Deer Island, this time for a year. By then, Rachel was utterly dependent on her welfare checks. For in late 1962, doctors at Boston City Hospital had finally diagnosed her frequent illnesses as manifestations of systemic lupus erythematosus, a disease which alters the body's immune system, giving rise to a legion of odd, seemingly unrelated symptoms.
severe arthritic pains in the joints, inflammation of the lungs, red, patchy lesions of the skin, malfunctions of the heart, kidney, liver, or central nervous system. Characteristically, her lupus would go into remission for several months or even a year, only to be followed by a relapse. She was in and out of the hospital dozens of times over the next decade. For 4 days in 1964, she was completely blind, only to mysteriously regain her sight. Several years later, she required a total hysterectomy. Still later, she had to have all her teeth removed. At times, she was profoundly depressed, preoccupied with fears of death or of life as a permanent invalid. She was hospitalized so often that she was unable to provide a home for her family, and late in 1962, her children were placed in black foster homes. Richard and George, then 8 and 7, went to stay with a Miss Bernice Cook on Braddock Park in the South End. Frederick and Wayne, 4 and 3, went to the Sneeds in Malden. Cassandra, 2, and Rachel, not yet a year old, went to the Freemans, also in Malden. They remained in these homes off and on for nearly 3 years, until in late 1964 they returned for good, joining their mother at her new apartment on Fenelon Street. Even when the worst of her hospital bouts were behind her, Rachel often found it difficult to care for her children. Occasionally, she suffered slight paralysis in her arms and legs. Once, she had a seizure while feeding 2-year-old Cassandra and dropped her onto the floor. At such times, her mother or her sister Alva would look after the children, but most members of the family were reluctant to help out. One female relative told the welfare department she would take Cassandra and young Rachel if she got $20 a week for each girl, 4 times the statutory figure. The social worker admonished her, saying that she should be willing to accept the responsibility without demanding a profit. Even Helen Walker didn't want to be saddled with her grandchildren for very long. As Helen was leaving Quinney, Rachel implored her to move in with her so the children wouldn't have to go into foster homes. When her mother flatly refused, Rachel was deeply wounded. Rachel never even considered asking for help from the aunts on her father's side. Loud, coarse women from Burke County, stereotypical homies. Sarah was a hopeless drunk. Fanny eventually went mad and was committed to Boston State Hospital for the insane. The only one of Quinney's relatives whom Rachel saw regularly was cousin Magnolia Williams, a late arrival from Burke County who settled in Boston in 1951. Although she was considerably older than Rachel, the two women managed a cordial, if ambivalent, relationship. One day in April 1964, Magnolia paid a call on Rachel. That spring, many Massachusetts whites were heading south to protest racial segregation, often getting arrested to dramatize their cause. Over coffee and donuts in Rachel's kitchen that day, the two women discussed the movement's latest cause célèbre, the arrest of Mrs. Malcolm Peabody, mother of Massachusetts Governor Endicott Chubb Peabody. Known for her proper Bostonian zeal for good works, the white-haired Mrs. Peabody had gone to St. Augustine, Florida, late in March, to demonstrate against segregated hotels and restaurants. When Mrs. John Burgess, wife of the first Negro suffragan bishop of the Episcopal Diocese of Massachusetts, was arrested in the lounge of the Ponce de Leon Motor Lodge, Mrs. Peabody and several other demonstrators courted arrest too. After 2 days and a night in jail, she proclaimed, "I will go to jail again if necessary to fight for civil rights." Martin Luther King sent a telegram lauding her as an inspiration to generations yet unborn. When she and Mrs. Burgess returned to Boston, demonstrators met them at the airport, carrying a banner which read, "Godspeed to the gallant ladies." Rachel thought that Mrs. Peabody was a wonderful woman, a modern exemplar of the abolitionist tradition. Magnolia wasn't so certain. "Oh, yeah," she said. "That's fine, going down to Florida to integrate some motel. But what's that lady and her son, the governor, doing about things up here?" "We don't have that kind of discrimination up here, Mag," said Rachel. "You think you don't?" "No," said Rachel. "Or at least we never used to." "You had it all along, honey, but you hid it under half a bushel."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.